Attention, podcast listener. We've got an exciting new podcast coming just for patrons of patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
Talking Futurama Season 2 Part 1 has begun exclusively for our $5 and up patrons on the Talking Simpsons Network. That's the first 10 episodes of Futurama coming to you once a week.
So just sign up for $5 a month at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, and you'll get Talking Futurama Season 2 and all of our limited miniseries, including the entirety of Talking Futurama Season 1. That's 13 episodes.
That is patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Now please enjoy the rest of this podcast.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where we bleed our own blood. I'm your host, the borderline psychotic Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons, who is here with me today.
Henry Gilbert, still waiting on my copy of Soldier of Fortune for this month.
And who is our special guest?
Hi, this is Chris Cabin, and I promise you victory and good times.
Excellent, and today's episode is Bart the General.
You've got to tell Principal Skinner, Bart. I can't squeal. It would violate the code of the schoolyard.
Today's episode aired on February 4th, 1990. And as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Oh boy, Bobby, the NFC beats the AFC in the Pro Bowl. Paula Abdul's Opposites Attract is number one on the Billboard music charts. And in a piece of news I just learned today, Billy Idol has a terrible motorcycle accident that breaks his leg, preventing him from playing T-1000 in Terminator 2.
Oh my God, I didn't know this.
Oh God.
Did you know this, Chris?
I had no idea. And we just did a Terminator 2 episodes. I had no idea.
Yeah, it was crazy to read. It was one of those things where you see it on Wikipedia, and I was looking like, what happened in music on February this of 1990? And it lists like February 6th, Billy Idol breaks leg in motorcycle accident, gets recast in Terminator. I'm like, no, that has to be one of these Wikipedia fake things. Can't be real. And I Google it, and like Robert Pattinson, Patrick. He gave an interview a couple of years ago of just like, yeah, Billy Idol broke his leg and they recast me late. Like, or the original Stan Winston props were Billy Idol's face is T-1000,
really?
Not me.
I didn't know. I feel like I should know this trivia. Wow.
No, I'm just now I can't stop but think about Terminator 2 as like a rock musical, like Walter Hill, Streets of Fire kind of stuff.
I'm just hearing Cradle of Love as a Terminator walks towards me to kill me very slowly. And Opposites Attract, I think, was it activated so many furries. It was part of the late 80s furry activation with Rescue Rangers and The Last Unicorn. And now we're living in the era of cats. And not to be a little stinker, but I'm kind of sick of hearing about cats.
I agree, actually. I'm with you on that.
People can have their fun. You can enjoy what you want to enjoy. As you guys say on your podcast, it's okay to like a movie. But I feel like I grew up with like 20 years of people making fun of cats, so to see people discovering it for the first time is just like infuriating me. Like, we knew it was crazy. We knew it was crazy and stupid for a long time.
But it's, I guess, okay to like a feline.
Yes, exactly. But I guess that people are allowed to be younger than us. It's legal.
Yeah, no, I mean, in the cats discourse, I am one of those people who just like, I saw cats in the 90s when it was a decade old as a child. and then I was like, yeah, this is crazy. But, you know, when a film comes out, it activates a lot of people in the cats
true.
That didn't know about it. I don't want to make new cats fans feel unwelcome, but there is a part of me that is the gatekeeper mentality of like,
yeah,
where were you for the last 40 years of cats?
It is just funny to see how people are constantly discovering these weird things. Like, I remember, this is Simpsons related, but 30 years ago, there was an episode of Get a Life called Zoo Animals on Wheels, which was a cat's parody. It was about the main character being in a cat's parody.
Bart and Milhouse see cats when they're on their squishy bender.
I put that as a gif on Twitter and said Simpsons predicted cats, just like 9/11 and iPhones.
I have the my cat story is that I went to see it as a young boy, and I was in line to get an autograph from, I think, Rum Tum Tigger. I can't say for sure on that one. I was about to get my autograph signed, and he was like, oh, gotta go back on stage.
I didn't know they were signing autographs.
Yeah, they did that for a while, I think, where like kids would come up in the intermission or right after the show and just line up for autographs.
That's cool.
Wasn't that the character like Llewellyn Sinclair played? Like, and I played Rum Tum Tugger
in the touring company of Cats. Anybody see it?
Yeah.
And as we all know, Rum Tum Tugger is a curious cat.
Is McClunky one of the cats, or did I just mix up my references?
That's a Star Wars thing.
You're thinking of McCavity.
Oh, McCavity. That's what I'm thinking of. Okay, the railway cats. Mm. And we're not going to talk about sports.
Nope, no 90s Pro Bowl talk here.
But we are going to talk about Chris Cabin. Thanks for being on the show, Chris.
Hey, thanks for having me again, guys.
Yes, we love We Hate Movies. It's a great podcast. You guys are coming off an amazing month, the worst of 2019, I believe.
Oh, God, yeah. That was rough.
And I also really loved your We Love Movies that was on your Patreon this month of the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. That was a really good one that was also like fair to criticisms people had of it while still, you know, celebrating what you guys enjoyed of the film.
Oh, yeah. I liked it. Was for me, it was a lot like the movie itself, where like we were just kind of hanging out and talking about the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like we didn't have a process of where we wanted to hit necessarily. But yeah. Everybody's right to have their criticisms of that movie, I'll say.
Were you guys hanging out shirtless like Brad Pitt does through the movie?
Look, I tried and the other guys just weren't into it.
What a bummer.
I really wanted to.
You know, it's funny. I've had my fair share of like man crushes, but I never found Brad Pitt like, you know, particularly attractive in something. Not like, obviously, he's always looks gorgeous and stuff. But when I saw him in the movie, like take his shirt off and start like fixing an antenna, I was like, wow, he is handsome. Oh my God.
He's a real silver fox, yes. Minus the silver.
56, this guy is. But yeah, no, thanks for coming on, Chris. And also, like you, I think we talked about your Simpsons fandom in the last time you were on here, but just for season one, were you there from the very beginning? Were you watching these episodes when they first aired?
My uncle was a crazy taper. He would just record. If he liked a show, he would just start recording it as soon as he knew he liked it. I wasn't there from the beginning, but I think I started watching the tapes right at the end of the first season, enough that I saw like the last episode of the first season.
Okay, so the pretty on board with it. I mean, that's helpful. It's always helpful to have a crazy uncle who's like the nerdy person gives you things.
Mine got me into all kinds of weird nerdy stuff.
and you try to be that good uncle to your the next generation.
I'm like my uncle, but without all the you know, crazy right-wing propaganda and Rush Limbaugh tapes.
Sounds like your uncle was Herman.
A bit, actually. Very close. No military
rather than
record.
Do the tapes, I'm going to start like teaching kids how to torrent.
Oh, they need to learn.
That's where you find it.
Kids are only going to learn that way.
So we need to begin with a writer's corner on John Swartzwelder. This is his first script. Now, we talked a lot about him. If you add up all of the like John Swartzwelder history clips on our podcast, you'll get like an hour and 45 minutes because there's so many stories about him on the commentary. So many great stories about him. But his origins are this. He was basically working in a Chicago ad agency in the mid-80s and submitting jokes to David Letterman via postcard, but with no attribution, just like writing in jokes.
Wow.
I guess for free.
Yeah. They pay you for a joke when they do it. There are a lot of writers who did that.
If your name isn't on it, how are they going to send you a check?
Well, I guess that's true.
Yeah.
Maybe they send a check to the return note there.
Could be, like paid out the cash, maybe. Yeah. But so Jim Downey of SNL was also reading these jokes as they were coming in, and he traced the location of the postcard based on the postmark, got in touch with Swartzwelder's mom, and then scheduled an interview for Swartzwelder to come in for SNL to interview.
I didn't know the mom part of that.
I didn't know it either, but this is when Letterman was still at NBC, of course. So they're like, who's writing these awesome jokes that are coming in? Mm-hmm. And they find him, they bring him in for an interview. Here's what happened. And this is all from the Wikipedia entry, which is, I'm just hearing this story now and I thought I knew everything. So Downey describes Swartzwelder's interview as, quote, one of the most spectacularly awful in history, as it consisted of him entering David Letterman's office without permission and discussing the state of television that it was all shit while smoking and drinking. While smoking and drinking, he was not hired for Letterman, but Downey hired him for Saturday Night Live beginning in 1985. So just barging into Dave Letterman's office while drunk and smoking, telling him TV sucked. Man, just to be in that office, to be a fly on the wall, the mythic meeting between Swartzwelder and Letterman.
That's an amazing story. I'd never heard that before. That, you know, other people, when they'd get there, like this kind of once in a lifetime Cinderella moment of like, you get to interview, to write for David Letterman, the most like celebrated rated smart comedy on network television at the time. For him, his thought was like, this is my opportunity to finally tell David Letterman television's bad.
David will get it.
Yes. Yeah. He'll get me. He's too real, just like me.
Sounds a bit like the plot of the Joker, actually. Or more specifically, I guess, King of Comedy.
Schwarzwalder was the original Joker. It's true. Yeah, it should be pointed out that like before our time, David Letterman was like the only funny guy on TV if you were a cool comedy nerd. Like there was no one else as funny and dark and subversive as Letterman in the early 80s. Mm-hmm. So when Schwarzwalder was hired for SNL, he shared a writing office with Robert Smigel, the famous writer.
Didn't know that either. Wow.
Yes, Triumph, the insult comic dog. Mm-hmm. And that's when he also met George Meyer and was fired mid-season in 1986. So he hired in 85, fired in 86.
I mean, that was the rough Lorne return season, right?
Yes.
So not much is remembered from that, I think, except for like a couple of Lovitz and Hartman sketches. I think nobody ever references it.
There was a shakeup in the upper. Somebody was trying to bring in more recorded material, I read. Like they wanted to do pre-recorded stuff.
Yeah, there was a big changeup happening behind the scenes. And I think George Meyer left in protest. Also because I think he liked John Swartzwelder. And that's why he hired John to work on his zine, Army Man, the mythical Army Man in which John Vitti, correct? George Meyer, John Swartzwelder, anyone else?
Those are the only three Simpsons writers I know of that worked on it.
Yeah. They were all like kind of Hollywood outsiders that were recruited to work on The Simpsons when Sam Simon was staffing up. I mean, Meyer worked on SNL, but he hated it and didn't make any friends there.
It's so special what Army Man the zine is, because it really is just like, you know, a bunch of friends basically who would just be goofing on Twitter with weird jokes. Yeah, but back then they're like, well, the only way we can do these weird jokes is to write them together and then print them ourselves and create a mailing list and do all that stuff.
Ian Fraser of The New Yorker, who's actually one of their best writers, I think was also on Army Man.
Oh, really? Yeah, that's cool.
He's really good.
If you look at an Army Man zine, and they're all scanned online, like some of the articles are just like a list of jokes as if they're tweets. I think George Meyer described the quintessential Swartzwelder joke is, they can kill the Kennedys, why can't they make a decent cup of coffee? It's like horror juxtaposed with the mundane.
Man, you get banned from Twitter for that joke.
Yeah,
now.
That's true. That'd be a ban. But yes, he wrote until season 15's The Regina Monologues. I believe that's the Simpsons are going to England episode. It was a season 14 holdover, so technically he was on from seasons 1 to 14. And he actually stopped coming into the office in season 6 because of LA's, and I believe California's as a whole, they had anti-smoking laws indoors. So he can no longer smoke in the writer's room. So he was allowed, because he was so talented, to work from home. And essentially, he bought a diner booth from his favorite diner.
Because he couldn't smoke in the diner to write anymore either.
He couldn't smoke there either. And he worked from home out of this diner booth in his own crazy house.
I think it's funny that he didn't do any commentaries, I think, out of like his own reclusiveness and also thinking they're stupid, I would assume. But then by not doing commentaries, every commentary is just full of like tall tales about him from all the writers who worked with him.
They are like Bill Brasky stories from that SNL sketch. But yeah, he still has written the most episodes of The Simpsons, 59. And from that last season he worked on, he rolled right into writing novels. Mm-hmm. And so far he's written a bunch of them and they're all very, very funny. And because he was just part of that ecosystem, in the mid-90s, he was given a development deal. John Swartzwelder was allowed to make a pilot. It is called Pistol Pete. It's online. It's not good, but it's also very fun to watch because it's John Swartzwelder writing Simpsons jokes for a live action cast who doesn't quite get it. And it's really fun to watch. I kind of want to cover it on a podcast soon because it's just a bizarre point in history in which John Swartzwelder, this crazy man, was allowed to make a Western pilot.
Like to be a man, like and be in a managerial role as like executive producer of something.
To be a boss. But yeah, we talked so much about him, but there's just a few more facts in general overview. 59 episodes of The Simpsons up to season 14, and his books are fantastic. They're all very short reads, all very funny, and that's he's still doing it. And he just turned 70 recently.
Wow, yeah. Man. He's defined on the commentary as like the right-wing crank of the Simpsons office, which I think they, you know, in the writer's room, at least in the early years, was kind of a novelty to them because you had all these like Harvard-educated, you know, liberal comedy writers, and then they have this like weird dude with a mustache like who just says, they're gonna hang Clinton from the rafters. And they, like,
it's... And it should be pointed out that Herman's design and sort of attitude is based on Swartzwelder, and the caricature is kind of him, but much later, I think in the front, you'll see a very unflattering caricature of Swartzwelder, a larger man.
Another of my favorite details about him, they said that, like, he'd be smoking the whole time, but also eating a bunch of Reese's peanut butter cups that he would, like, stack up on the arms of his chair and eat them one at a time as he goes. Like, but we could be telling Swartzwelder stories all day. The one new one since we last talked about Swartzwelder on the podcast, I think, was hearing Mike Reese in one of his many interviews he did about his book on his time on The Simpsons. There's a whole section about working with John Swartzwelder, and he had nothing but complimentary things to say. He was like, what a nice guy. He is weird, though, and he mentioned that, like, he had heard Swartzwelder did own a Hitler painting just for the novelty of owning a painting Hitler made.
He can't afford it.
The thing with Swartzwelder is I think he always knew that giving somebody a good story to tell was probably better than being, like, logical or competent or, you know, consistent. So that's what I always think of when the Letterman story comes by. That's what I always think. I'm like, that whoever was doing that interview was talking about that guy for years.
Yeah. But in most of those cases, it's like, and that's the story of the guy we didn't hire. But in this case, what an interesting guy. I hope somebody gets to interview him someday, but I feel like he just, it's also crazy to hear, like, he's, like, seemingly unmarried and, like, lives with his brother, and that's, like, it's
and
different.
His health is, I guess, pretty good. You hear weird stories about his health on the podcast, not on the podcast, on the commentaries, too, and that he felt, like, running short bursts was, like, very healthy, and also he would go to the Mayo Clinic to get a very expensive appointment once a year, and I believe that is what inspired Mr. Burns going in and the Manson family. Three Stooges syndrome, where the various viruses couldn't get through the door.
Yeah, Swartzwelder would always brag that as the story went, he would brag that he's like, actually, they tell me I'm more healthy than ever and that smoking is good. So there. Same with, like, he was one of those people who'd say, well, actually, there's more rainforest now than there ever was, and it's good to burn it down.
And seatbelts cost more lives than they save.
Yeah. I think whenever a character says something like that, they're just paraphrasing a Swartzwelderism from the room. Though, comparatively, there's not much of that crankness in this other than Herman. Herman is where they put the Swartzwelderisms in there. When you describe his looks, I remember Conan O'Brien saying that, like, if he was a... like mid-1800s police officer, like, walking around the streets of Boston, he would be the most handsome one of the time.
He really would.
He's basically John C. Reilly's character from Gangs of New York.
Oh, like, my God, you're right. I can see it now.
Well, also, the director of this one, David Silverman, we talked a ton about him before, but one thing I had forgotten about until hearing the commentary that really is nuts to me now. So he had just directed Bart the Genius. He is now working on this one, and he boarded Bart the General. So he is concurrently directing Bart the Genius and boarding Bart the General. That is an insane workload to put on anybody. And I think they just didn't have the work practices figured out yet, that they didn't realize it was horribly overworking.
Yeah, that one man couldn't direct, what, like, four episodes?
He directed four episodes that season. Jeez. out of 13.
Like, more than a third.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we would never do anything like that anymore. But no. Put too much on an animator's desk. That was just, or a director of animator.
They're all well paid and, good health insurance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Certainly by streaming companies, too. They treat him very well and very respectfully. And also, this one on the DVDs is one of the few on the season one DVDs that has the original Trable draft script in full.
Matt Groening's copy,
it's
correct?
It's Matt Groening's copy, yeah. So I read through the whole thing right before this and made some notes about big changes that were made. There are a few, and I'll get to them in order in the episode, but... the table draft itself is pretty interesting, just in that, like, there's Matt Groening doodles in there. You can even see him, like, what I think is his first try, like, what would I draw Nelson as? And and also some big additions to it that are, like, in Matt Groening's like writing on the page. So it's pretty interesting. I kind of wish they put more of the table drafts in the DVD extras, but I think they didn't because it shows you, like, I think it showed too much of how the sausage is made. I think they got afraid to show that much. much.
I also think they're like, well, who is going to look at this on their on their SD TV in 2001?
No,
yeah,
true,
like who is this for? Do you want to get to the opening?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, so the opening is like a very weird edit of the opening in which it's the normal opening for season one, but once you get to the school, there's like a weird like video-y freeze and a weird video-y zoom in, and then you fade to the Simpsons house and you kind of video freeze on that and then zoom in. It's like very awkward, but I really feel like they had to make room for Bart's speech at the end, which was an addition.
Yeah. I think that's you're right. That's the big change they had to make. This is a first. They'd never edited the opening to this point. This is, you know, the fifth episode. They're finally like, we're out of time. Like, this would be a constant thing for the Simpsons of chopping up around their opening either longer or shorter to fit in jokes and or to cover for a lack of enough scenes. But this is the first time, and you can see how primitive the technology and tools they had at the time were, because there's like, okay, just stop it here. And nobody, I guess on an SD TV, maybe the freeze frame artifacting isn't as obvious, but it does look bad now.
It's very obvious now.
And also, you know, a very proto Rugrats opening too, of starting in an oven with a close up of it. Like Silverman mentioned, he loves posing like that, of starting a scene or a opening of an episode with a bewildering close up of something that takes a viewer a second to be like, wait, what am I looking at? I think they really ripped him off on Rugrats for that at Klatsky Chupo.
You never start inside of a baby's mouth, though.
Well, fortunately not. Though you do ride inside giant Maggie's mouth in Simpsons the Ride, though.
Somebody's getting off to that. I think you pointed that out.
Yes.
There's some vore stuff on that ride.
It's a horrifying moment. It is.
I have one thing up front, though. Mm-hmm. A weird thing. So if you look at all the season one merch and games, especially video games, they really had to look very hard. Like, what can we mine from this? And for whatever reasons, somebody pointed out that, cupcakes are a very important element of the Simpsons world, because cupcakes play a very important role in this first act. Mm-hmm. And also cupcakes play into the beginning of Moaning Lisa, where she says, a simple cupcake will bring me no joy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So that's why there's a 1990 Tiger Electronics game called Bart Simpson's Cupcake Crisis. Because they're like, what does Bart do? He likes cupcakes.
Oh.
And there's an entire little handheld dinky LCD game about Bart eating cupcakes and stealing them and stuff. So,
man, I never saw that one. I gotta look that up. That's, you know, they might have more cupcakes than squishies in season one, or an equal amount. These cupcakes bug me. They never looked appetizing to me as a kid.
That's the tragedy of it, is that like they look like absolute garbage, and like later you get a little frosting and like a cherry on top occasionally, I feel.
Oh,
that,
yeah,
that's the look I usually remember for this.
I think in Duffless we got better cupcakes
when Bart is imitating the scene from Clockwork Orange and he's falling down as he grabs for two cupcakes. Those are appetizing looking cupcakes.
These look more like muffins to me, honestly. But I mean, I only eat cupcakes like every 8 years when I go to a wedding, because no one has cakes, like actual cake that you cut anymore, which is fine.
I think it's
except Henry, who sold out to the cake industry.
Yeah, but a wonderful, delicious $300 cake.
I enjoyed my $30 piece of it.
And that's just a two-tiered cake, by the way. But I've had cupcakes a few times because my husband he works in an office. And so every now and then he'll come home like, they got us cupcakes. I brought home a few. I think the mistake here is coloring. I think it was not supposed to be brown on brown. I think
brown on brown.
I think it's supposed to come out as a brown cupcake, but then have different color frosting. But so when Lisa is putting like brown frosting on a brown cupcake, it's just, I didn't even read it as chocolate. I read it as like bran or something. It just never looks good.
It looks like they're smearing molasses on a bran muffin. And that's disgusting. Like, I don't want to eat that. Nobody wants to eat. Like, it'd be one thing if it was just like one of those crumble cake muffins or like a chocolate chip muffin, maybe I understand, but like,
whenever I have a chocolatey muffin or a sweeter muffin, I'm just like, why isn't this just a cupcake? What are we doing with this muffin here?
That's my feeling with like Starbucks Frappuccino things. I'm like, just have a milkshake.
Yeah.
Like, just do that.
The sad truth is they just are milkshakes.
people, if they would feel, you know, they're being unhealthy if they lined up for like a milkshake every morning. But if it's their coffee, it's fine.
Unfortunately, most cups of coffee don't have 1,200 calories. So
it's like having a black cup of coffee and then a big bag of M&Ms. That's
Mr. The Simpsons will be right back.
Sunday.
Keep it down. Am I making myself so?
Bart declares war on the local bully.
Instead of fighting, why don't you try a little understanding?
Well, thank you very much, Mrs. Maharishi Gandhi.
But never fear.
Let me help you dry those tears.
Sunday at 8:30 on Fox 5.
We hope you're enjoying this podcast while keeping your arms inside of the bus. And a big thank you to our guest this week, Chris Cabin from the We Hate Movies podcast. Always awesome to have him on. So glad he could join us for this re-exploration of the first season for the 30th anniversary. We Hate Movies is a great podcast. And if you'd like to support this podcast and get every episode of Talking Simpsons 1 week ahead of time and without ads like this one, you need to go over to the Patreon at patreon.com/Talking Simpsons. Subscribers there support me and Bob doing this full time as our real ass jobs. So please, $5 a month makes a big, big difference. And you get so many cool things. You get this podcast a week ahead of time and ad-free. You could hear next week's right now. And the same goes for our sister podcast, What a Cartoon, where we talk about a different animated series once a week. Plus, at $5 a month, get you over 100 exclusive Patreon podcasts, an ever-growing list of them. Our exclusive mini-series where we talk about episodes of The Critic, Futurama, and King of the Hill in the same style as Talking Simpsons, community podcasts, deleted scenes, season wrap-ups, and over 20 interviews with folks who have worked on The Simpsons, many for decades and decades. You can only hear those if you're a $5 and up supporter at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. Want something even nicer than fresh baked cupcakes? Then that is at the $10 and up level at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. You know all that $5 stuff I just talked about? Well, you get that. And a monthly exclusive extra long bonus podcast, What a Cartoon Movie. Me and Bob talk for over 4 hours many times about a different animated feature film once a month. Recent episodes of What a Cartoon Movie have covered The Animatrix, Toy Story, Iron Giant, all of which we talked about in detail, both the history and going scene by scene through the films. And the back catalog has so many great ones. Kiki's Delivery Service, Tiny Toons How I Spent My Vacation, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, Aladdin, A Goofy Movie, Beavis and Butthead Do America. So many great podcasts, over 50 hours of great podcasts to listen to, and there's a new one every month. So please, if you really enjoy what we're doing, sign up at the $10 level or upgrade your pledge and get to hear all of that at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. Lisa is preparing cupcakes, and Homer takes a specific lesson from it.
These are for Lisa's class.
It's Mrs. Hoover's birthday.
You know, there are names for people like you.
No, there aren't.
Teacher's pet, apple polisher, butt kisser.
Bart, you're saying butt kisser like it's a bad thing.
Huh?
Well, you see, boy, never hurts to grease the wheels a little.
I'm not greasing the wheels, Dad. I like my teacher.
Sure, Lisa. You see how it works, Bart? A cupcake here, a good grade there.
Dad, I get good grades because I'm smart and I pay attention and I study hard.
Yeah, right, Lisa. It's the three roads to success, Bart. Work, brains, and...
Oh, brother.
Uh-oh, school bus, gotta go.
Oh!
Very cartoony zip-arounds a lot in this here, including like Lisa's zip in and zip out, taking the cupcake back.
And a lot of the early Simpsons in season one is about Homer teaching the wrong lessons to kids. I feel like the joke in the future is that he would just be too inattentive and drunk or lazy to even engage on this level with Bart. Like, he would not say, get up on my knee, son. Here's time for a lesson.
Yeah, he'd be too lazy to even do that. Like this. Also, Homer has a couple things in here. Like, this is too clever for Homer. He's not the big dumb... As Swartzwelder has described him, the dog who can say his own name. at Summer.
Says, I love you on command.
So this is the first mention of Miss Hoover, though Lisa says Mrs. Hoover.
Oh.
And it's surprising that Miss Hoover, like, she doesn't appear until late season two. Like, you'd think she'd be in Moaning Lisa because Lisa has problems at school. You think you'd see your teacher, but not so. Miss Hoover on screen didn't appear until very late season two, Brush with Greatness, and not even in a school context.
Oh, he's bad, but he'll die, so I like it, right?
That's her? Yeah. I think they wrote that scene and made up a character to say it, and then in a coming episode, they're like, oh, we need the Miss Hoover. Okay, well, let's draw her in here. Like, let's just use that old one.
Was Lisa substitute the first one with
I
her
think
officially?
In class, yeah.
Yeah. But
the Wikipedia puts her Brush with Greatness as the first on-screen appearance.
Interesting. Then that's true, and Lisa famously loves Miss Hoover and wants to give her things. Treats.
Yeah. Yeah, I wonder how they wanted to play this. Like, they kind of... The Lisa we know does not suck up to teachers, and she really is doing it to be nice, but I think they hadn't decided that yet at this time. I think they want you to wonder, like, is Lisa a butt kisser or is she just a nice student? You know,
well, what's funny to me is that I feel like Mrs. Hoover would be the first one to be telling Lisa, don't be a butt kisser.
Yeah. Yes.
She's seen it all, really.
She's the most devoid of emotion. Like, yeah. she's more broken down than Krabappel.
Yeah, like, Edna's got a spark to her. Hoover's just defeated and jaded.
Mm-hmm. And drinking Drambuie all day.
And Krabappel, like, it's an ebb and flow. Like, she's disappointed, then all of a sudden, like, she gets passionate again, and then it dissipates again, whereas Hoover just seems like a total flatline.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I can also see why Lisa gets so depressed in the next episode, because her father is just fully saying, like, you don't earn your grades. You're not smart. Who cares? You just suck up to people. That's actually pretty hurtful on Homer's part, especially like, yeah, right. There's several lines in here that are Homer being bad specifically to Lisa, which I think is definitely a Swartzwelder trait of his script.
Also not involving Marge in the plot at all.
Yeah, yeah.
Marge is still sort of just hovering in the background, trying to get into the stories this early.
When Marge does appear in this story, it's mainly to show that moms are useless.
Yeah.
But that was another thing in Mike Reese's book. He said that Swartzwelder had the strange proclivity of turning in scripts where Lisa and Marge do not appear and they have to add them in rewrites. But yeah, I also love Homer's like, Bart, you're saying butt kisser like it's a bad thing. It's just a funny line to say. So they get on the bus and they meet up with Otto for this brief little scene.
So the funny thing about the bribe talk, like it's good to butt kiss and stuff, like, it's like I had a grandfather who was a bookie for the Jewish mafia.
Oh, nice.
And he would, him and my dad always, like, kind of always said stuff like this.
Wow.
Like, they didn't think of it as a weird thing. They always were like, yeah, you know, sometimes, yeah. They never used grease the wheels, but then I learned grease the wheels later. I was like, oh, that's what they were trying to tell me.
You, as an innocent child, you couldn't understand.
Yeah, that works. Give them stuff.
I don't know if I'd rather be a podcaster or part of the Jewish mafia now.
It's probably all too businessy now. Yeah. Too many layers of management. Not the fun way it was 80 years ago. Yeah, you know, I don't think I ever got this kind of speech of, like, why it's good to suck up. I think, you know, as I would learn in the working world, it was better to have a boss like you than not like you, even if you did a good job, which I'm glad those bosses sucked. I'm glad they didn't like me.
I think the real reason, though, is sucking up is what gets people to take advantage of you. It's just like, oh, that loser will do anything for us. He'll stay late. He'll scrub toilets. He'll just be a little apple polisher. Just exploit him. The guy doesn't care. Don't trust him with anything.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, you can't win, honestly.
Yeah, I didn't get to that point until junior high, and I had been taken advantage of plenty by that.
Although when I did teach college writing classes, I did like the suck-ups, because they were at least engaged and paying attention.
You know what? All right, well, this is very pro-suck-up then, I think.
Depends on what kind of job you're in, I guess.
Yeah.
So the kids get on the bus. They really used Otto a lot in these first seasons.
They loved Otto.
They thought he'd be like, yeah, Bart's cool older friend. We're going to get so many stories out of this character. He's his stoner buddy. This brief little moment here is the first time he's hung around Lisa.
Yo, Otto Man.
Yo, Bart Dude.
Hey, can you believe it, man? My sister here made a whole pile of cupcakes to butter up her teacher, and she won't give anybody else even one measly little crumb.
That's bad news, man.
Here, Otto, I made an extra one for you.
Oh, thanks, little lady.
You're welcome.
I like how just emptily Otto except like, no, oh, that sucks. Okay, thanks. Like he has no judgments either way on it. The drawings in this, we did that live show of weird drawings, and here's another one we could add to it of like, I think Bart and Lisa, when they're talking to Otto, or when Bart's saying like, she won't even share one with us, like their heads look like jack-o'-lanterns on them. Like they're really big heads.
I just looked it up in Frankie Yak now, and it's they're odd.
They are giant. I mean, again, Rugratsy kind of heads there. It feels more in the Klasky Chupo verse of them.
There's a lot of moments in season one where it looks like they're unhinging their jaws like a snake to eat something.
Yeah,
it's really, really, really disturbing.
I was looking at the scene, and there's a lot of characters who they're like their mouth line extends behind their head when they're talking. So like the mouth is like sort of like just jutting out behind the flesh.
Yeah, which I think is a fun drawing style, but when you're used to the more defined and solid Simpsons episodes that don't break those rules for cartoony effect, it does seem crazy. Like, this is getting ahead of ourselves in the season one redo, but I think my most favorite extreme version of their giant mouths is when they wish Marge a happy birthday and wake her up, happy birthday! Like, their mouths are two times the size of their heads.
That's almost like a Charlie Brown kind of parody, yeah. Almost.
But they head to the back. This is where there's a, I think this is a very realistic, like, sibling interaction here of realizing you pissed off your sibling, they're not going to help you, so time to correct course and pretend that you like them so they'll give them what you want. And also in this scene, there's a lot of dot-eyed children on the bus, too.
Yeah.
Mostly there's good character designs in this compared to like Homer's Odyssey and some of the freaks in there, but there's still a lot of background weirdos in here.
Yeah, when Bart is trying to escape from the schoolyard much later, he sort of darts by these two dot-eyed children staring vacantly and not moving. It's very distracting.
But here is Bart's convincing Lisa to get himself a cupcake.
Better let me hold these, Lisa.
Forget it.
You sniveling toad, you little egg sucker.
Tell me more.
Back scratcher, foot licker, honor student.
You'll never get one now, Mr. Name Caller.
All right. Look, I'm sorry. I got upset. In the heat of the moment, I said some things I didn't mean.
You weren't thinking, were you?
No.
I'm not a sniveling toad, am I?
Not really.
I'm not a little egg sucker, am I?
Of course not.
Then what am I?
A beautiful human being.
What do you like best about me?
Well, I'd have to say, your generous nature, your spirit of giving.
Well, open your mouth and close your eyes and you will get a big surprise.
Frankly, you're the best.
That's disgusting.
You know, I have kind of a 5-second rule with food, but I would make an exception for something with like creamy frosting that would streak down the ground. Yeah.
Also, a school bus. It's a specific kind of germ factory you're talking about there.
That's true. If I drop something on, say, the BART train in San Francisco, that is gone forever and I would never touch. Even if it's not food, I'd be like, well, my wallet's gone. No more wallet for me.
That's for the rats now.
But this the fun BART non-apology. I really like that writing of him. Of like, look, some things were said. Let's just move on. And it also, I like, it does feel very taken from real life of a sibling realizing they've got one on you. Like, what else do you like about me? Like, it's a cool little moment that you don't get many brother-sister moments with Lisa and Bart until this episode, I think. And Bart really takes on, like, a traditional bratty older brother in this, doing things I don't think he would do in, like, even a season 3 episode, because he'd be like, that's too obvious of a thing an older brother would do. Let's go in an opposite direction.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff is really on the nose, where they would try to subvert it or twist it or add an interesting wrinkle like this, and the bully stuff and Skinner stuff. We'll talk more about that later, though.
Yeah, I mean, the bully messaging in this, it isn't that different from a concurrently airing Tiny Toons episode where Hampton gets bullied by Montana Max and he has to learn what to do if you're getting bullied. And I'm sure none of us were bullied as the cool kids we were in school.
No, never.
Yeah,
No.
This isn't tell your most horrible bullying stories moment. But yes, this was more when I saw this at 7, was a preview of bullying to come in my life.
Oh, this is a fictional situation. situation, correct?
Fortunately, this will never happen. I mean, the only fictional thing is banding together friends to help you defeat a bully.
Thankfully, all the bullying was really psychological in my case. Mm. It didn't mess with me at all in ways I still remember today.
Okay, no way.
I was like one of two like big kids in my grade, and the other one like got it into his head immediately. I was stupid at the time. He got into his head immediately. He's like, I have to take this guy out. This guy's got to be the one who takes all the fat jokes from me. So we fought, and I thought, I mean, it was my first fight. I have not been in many. And I got my clock cleaned.
Ooh.
Well, I mean, school is meant to train you for prison. Those are good rules to learn.
Yeah.
Good lessons to learn.
You know, I never got in a physical fight in up to junior high. But I did like it was more, you know, the psychological torture was also a physical threat implicit of like,
yeah,
this will happen. But I also do remember the battle for like not to be the lowest rung on the ladder in the classroom of like this. I have to make sure this other guy. I mean, that's a horrible thing that it makes you feel guilty of like, well, I helped another person be bullied, so I would be bullied slightly less. These are the things that haunt you.
I was lucky in that I had a guy in my grade who was in a bunch of classes with me too, and he only showered like once a month.
Ooh.
In the middle of puberty. So I got off a little light on that one because he took everything.
That's very lucky.
I remember that, and this is a little bit dark, but I remember when in seventh grade, there was like a new kid in our class and clearly like the nerdiest, most, you know, outsider kid ever. And all of us nerds breathe a sigh of relief. Like, okay, woo, we just moved up a little bit.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, welcome to Easy Street.
Well, this is that code of the schoolyard that it did, like, we didn't call it that, but these were the things you understood in school that you learned through. I'd hope with all the, like, last, like, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years of anti-bullying talk in the media, I hope it's better for kids in school now. I hope it's not as, like, torturous and awful. And at the very least, like, a teacher enforces anti-bullying stuff a bit more, but... I mean, kids will always be assholes. They're like the most sociopathic beings on earth, I think.
I think it's only gotten worse now that everyone can film everybody all the time and take pictures.
Oh, God.
So, yeah.
You're right. Yep. Yeah.
I think the stuff in school has gotten much better. And I think everything online just has like, it's like a hitting the early school stuff with like radioactivity.
Yeah, you're right. I am actually very, now that you've said that, I'm very happy I did not go to school in a time when every child had a phone that could film anything I did.
I can't imagine if I have the tools I have now back in like 1993, what would even happen to me?
So yeah, this is this story is even more quaint because it is like a 50s or 60s bullying scenario.
It really is, yeah. I mean, there are very like traditional relationships in the season one stuff that would eventually be twisted and exaggerated. Like Bart is afraid of his scary principal who's very stern, and he's afraid of this bully who's very mean and will hit him. Mm-hmm. Like Skinner and Nelson would become much more interesting characters and much sadder characters after this. But like I think the one wrinkle to the Nelson bully thing to make it kind of like fun in 90s is like, oh, he has assistants that like schedule beatings for him. That's like the one little addition to this that makes it more than a standard bully story.
I think his assistants are called Weasel 1 and Weasel 2 in the script.
The wiki calls them Yellow Weasel and Black Weasel, that could be them in the script. Did the script say that?
I don't believe it denoted race in the script. It just was, there's one and two, so maybe the wiki should update to one and two instead of making it a race thing.
And they would stick around as background characters very rarely. I think they're still just hanging around in the background, but Nelson would just sort of enter the orbit of Jimbo Dolphin Kearney after they were invented.
I just remember them. Don't they come back in the when Bart races with Martin Prince's car?
Oh, I think you're right.
Yeah, they're always with him in that one, too. I think that was the last time they were in their traditional roles as Nelson's assistants.
Wow, season 3. So yeah. I guess they stuck around a little longer than I thought.
That one debuted with a music video you don't talk about anymore. Yeah.
Deep, Deep Trouble, right?
No, Michael. Yeah. It was Michael Jackson's Black or White, just to be clear, for history's sake. Okay. But those characters, I mean, even in season 3, 3, when you see the weasels again, they really do look very season 1 because they're twins in design, but clearly not meant to be related to each other. So it's just kind of a very distracting, cartoony choice they wouldn't make in character designs, even in season 2, you know. Just a repeated design with race swapped in it is, or a palette swap, I guess you would say, in video game terms.
This is like the Scorpion and Ermac or whatever of Nelson's world.
Or when, like, Blanca was blue.
Yeah. Oh,
I'm sorry, so, Scorpion and, let's say, Smoke. Ermac was an unrelated robot ninja.
Or Sub-Zero or Scorpion.
Yeah,
or
Reptile.
Reptile, they all were. Yeah. Rain.
Rain,
That's the purple one because it was a Prince reference.
Yeah, I think, like, Ermac was the robot and there was, like, new Cybots or whatever. And, well, yeah. Sorry.
Also in this bit, like, Bart's acting like a very just straightly written big brother in here. Of like, hey, man, that's my sister. Like that. It's a very big brother moment for him that I would see even in season 3, Bart going like, hey, you fight your own battles, or I'm not doing that. Or if he did big brother help, it would be helping her like plot to do something evil, not really fighting another kid on his behalf.
And we were doing, on a recent live show, showing off the wrong race character. So we have White Lou in this season. We have Black Smithers. We also have White Janie, who's a different character altogether.
Oh, yeah.
She's like, have a cupcake, Janie, and Janie's just a different person.
I totally missed that.
Yeah.
You're right. That the often heard of Janie, Lisa's only friend, who barely even likes her. The squishing of the cupcakes, I think that's really well done. You feel like, something is lost here when he steps on it. I think something not fully communicated in the animation, but I think what's happening when the Weasel 1 is grabbing the cupcakes, he's biting just the creamy top off of them and tossing the other part behind him.
I think I caught that this time, but not before.
Yeah, you gotta pop the top.
I mean, that's the only part that's good.
My cousin used to eat the tops and then, like, I'm not kidding you, a soup spoon full of butter and just drag it on the top of what was left.
Oh, dude.
And it was, I even me as a young butter lover was like, oh.
Oh, God. But yes, then Bart is interrupted from saving his sister with the arrival of Nelson Muntz, his first appearance. It's funny on the commentaries in season 1, Groening's talking about how, like, the toy makers and the video game people were like, you need to give Bart more enemies because that's who he fights, or that's the other toy we're going to use. And I think that's why Nelson was one of the first of the run of non-Simpsons family characters to get a toy. Mm.
Oh, the ones with the weird, like, word bubbles you just stick in their head, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. Yeah, I remember many a time in my childhood having my Bartman figure fight my Nelson figure.
And were they non-posable?
They had, no, their shoulders could move. These were not the bendy ones.
Got
these were these were a little later. The bendy ones were like year 1. I think year 2 is when they had the ones with the shoulders and hips and heads could swivel, but otherwise stiffer plastic. And those are good. I even had I had all of the family plus Nelson and Bartman. Bartman and Bart were separate figures. And I had the couch that also came with the TV where you could switch out the picture that was on the TV. Those are some good Simpsons toys.
I remember having the Bartman one that could fight. But the stretchy ones, I don't remember.
I had a couple of the stretchy ones that were just, they were your usual, you know, wire under plastic bendy guys. They were pretty cheap and also made of very heavy plastic.
Yeah, not fun to play with.
Unless you needed to beat your sibling with something. Like, it's pretty quality
batter.
It was
a good cudgel.
I mean, that comes up more than you would think.
It's useful. It's useful.
What can I put in a sock?
A G.I. Joe, you'd have to put a lot of G.I. Joe's in a sock, but one Bart head, just wham, you're taking your brother's crying after that.
You're breaking skin, buddy.
So Nelson Muntz, this might be apocryphal because I could never find it, but I swear in the early Bongo comics, they'd have like each month Matt Groening would do like a little editorial telling some story. And he told a story about how like partially Nelson Muntz was influenced by a lot of different bullies in his life. But one of them was Frank Miller, the comic creator. And he says,
what?
It's kind of informed by him. Again, I don't know how much that was bullshit that he just made up for an essay, but I swear to you, Bongo comic collectors, find this essay for me. I swear it's out there.
Interesting.
But yeah, Nelson makes his first appearance, and he has quite a good line here.
Nelson, you're bleeding.
Nah, happens all the time. Somebody else's blood splatters on me. Hey, wait a minute. You're right. You made me bleed my own blood.
It was an accident, man. A terrible, ghastly mistake. Ask anybody. Uh-oh. A cold wind.
Hello, kids. Everything above the board here? Good. Play friendly, children. Uh-oh, there's your bell. Come along now, all of you. No dawdling now.
I'll get you after school, man.
But...
Oh, no. He'll get you after school, son. Now hurry up. It's time for class.
But...
Scoot, young Simpson. There's learning afoot.
Boy, you know, like the doofy, gentle prodding of Skinner feels very different than the Skinner from Bart the Genius.
Yeah.
It feels like they weren't sure that, like, Schwarzwald didn't get the memo about who Skinner was. Just the very still, like, move along, young Simpson. There's learning afoot. Just, it feels very different than Bart the Genius.
Yeah, this is not the Skinner trying to get Bart expelled from the school and gotten rid of, and he was tired of him.
I think if any authority figure used the word afoot to me at that age, I'd be saying, what the fuck did you say?
What are these words?
What are you talking about?
I also, one of my favorite drawings in this is the weird change in Skinner's face when he goes like, uh-oh.
Yeah.
made me bleed my own blood. What a great line.
Yeah, that's a standout of season one.
And just from Bart's wild, just arm flailing about when he gets picked up like that. I also like, they're like, no, it happens all the time. I get tons of blood on me from other people I beat. And that actually is a rewrite on Matt Groening's script. It was not there in the original Schwarzwelder draft turned in.
Hmm.
You know, this bit about like the silence of the schoolyard, how you're being, you know, nobody is sticking up for you in this moment and they're just leaving you to be killed by Nelson. I think that's more of Groening, you know, taking from his childhood, and just it was when he had more of his childhood to mine, and when it was more recent in his memory, because he was like 30, early 30s when these first episodes were airing. It's one thing that they're not going to like rat them out to Skinner, but Skinner is witness to a threat, and that's how useless he is there.
I think he's choosing to misread it.
Well, what else is he going to do? Like, he knows his place in society as well as anyone. He has to enforce. Preventing bullying is counter to what they need in the school, as far as he sees it.
I think he's probably still of the generation who's like, that builds character.
Mm-hmm. I was bullied a lot, and it made me strong. Yeah, I'd see that. Also, not in the script are the two dream sequences in this. Like,
there's just like it's like a real dream sequence sandwich, and the dream sequences are the bread coming up.
I wonder if they had like, they were like, oh, we've got two ideas. Oh, why choose? Let's just cut a couple things. And I think the dream sequences, I would wonder if like Groening wanted to add them because he just enjoyed the dream sequences from the shorts as well. Or if it was like Silverman at the storyboard stage of like, hey, how about a little dream sequence, you know?
It really helps lighten the mood from Bart's constant dread throughout the school day. You can have a little more fun.
And this one of him being chased by the Terminator-esque Nelson Muntz, the unstoppable one. I like the bullets bounce off him. They say in the commentary they could only get away with shooting at him in a dream if the bullets bounced off.
I think I remember as a kid just seeing the knives going to Nelson was kind of shocking. Just like it felt like an edgy a choice that I wasn't expecting, like him to be stabbed and just shove all the knives away.
And also the drawing of Bart holding the machine gun is such a fun drawing. Yeah.
It's like Daffy Duck holding a machine gun.
It's Nancy doing Nelson, one of her like most consistent characters, but I think his voice lightens over the years, but this is a pretty close to the Nelson she'd be doing.
And we get ha 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 instead of ha ha like that.
You're right. I believe the first ha ha is when he rides by on his bike when Bart is selling lemonade and Lisa's like, oh no, do this. And she turns all the things around like, now you look pathetic. And then, oh no, wait, no, sorry.
Oh, it was
was misreporting it.
Yes. Was it the one where they're having a party and Grandpa's babysitting them?
It's in the War of the Roses episode.
Yeah.
As they're having the party, his pants, he's like, "You want me to take off my belt? Sure. Okay." And his pants drop. Ha ha. That's the first official one. But I can see them hearing in the mix here, like, "Oh, it's funny how slowly Nancy says, ha ha ha."
Well, there's another creepy delivery. He like goes she goes into like a creepy whisper. She's like, "I'll see you again tomorrow, Simpson."
Yeah, I don't think she knew how like ugly and stupid he would look. So
yeah,
she plays him a little smarter in this too. Yeah.
A little Hannibal Lecter-y, I felt.
Yeah. Well, in this sequence, I think this defines him more as the physical presence the animators saw Nelson as than as maybe the writing did, I think. Yeah. I really like the animation of Bart running up the staircase and then the background turns into Nelson and he plucks him up and eats him.
The thing about Nelson eating Bart reminded me of Simpsons Bible stories that we just did, which ends the same way, except Nelson explodes.
You're right. Yeah. Yes. Bart learned from his dream, his previous dreams of like, "Oh, I know that's his perfect weak point to throw in a fire into his mouth." So he explodes. Then Bart is woken up by Milhouse, which this is like the most like normal for Milhouse scene in season one, I think, of Milhouse acting like Milhouse.
Except he is being a bit of a wiener, trying to get Bart to squeal.
That fits for Milhouse, yeah. Wouldn't he be? He's a squealer. But that Milhouse should have been in more scenes in this. There's like two other scenes in this where a different kid is in there. I'm like, "Well, you had Milhouse before, just have Milhouse be there." But back then, Milhouse was just one of Bart's many friends instead of his only friend.
He was on the same level as Richard and Lewis and Wendell.
Oh, Wendell.
So many more stories to tell about all of them.
Can you believe that the nerdy guys who wrote for The Simpsons were most attracted to writing the dork?
I'm shocked and appalled.
So they head into the cafeteria. That's where everybody like welcomes Bart as Bart the Bully Killer. And I do love his line of like, "I'm not saying I'm not a hero. I'm just saying I fear for my safety." That's a good one. That's one of the smarter lines than you remember in this season. Like he's fine with everybody celebrating him. Other than that, he'll be beaten by Nelson. And then there's another very cartoony zip away when Nelson appears in the cafeteria and all the kids zip away from him and leave him alone. I really like the posing too on like Nelson over Bart's head as Bart's like, "It's a real funny story, man. Like, get this, dude." And Nelson's just like 3:15 after class.
Is he drawn to be like much bigger than Bart in this episode?
I think he's pretty much normally head above Bart. I think so. Yeah. Though in the posing of this, Bart is seated on a cafeteria seat and he's standing over him. So I think it makes the size disparity more than usual.
Yeah, and I mean, there's a certain expressionistic thing to it. It's fine.
And then comes the next of the two dream sequences in this episode. And the funnier of them, I think, this funeral sequence, I just love every line in this here.
"Goodbye, little dude. You look so lifelike, man."
"Yes, the school nurse did a wonderful job reconstructing his little face after the fight. Goodbye, son." "I guess you were right. All that homework was a waste of your time."
"Thanks, Bart. We got the day off from school for this."
"Yeah, and I got the day off from work."
"Homer!
But what's a day off from work when I'm never going to see my beloved son again? Oh, Bart! Oh, Bart!"
"That's better, Homer. Be brave. Bye-bye, Bart. You're always my special little guy."
"Bart, here's that cupcake you wanted. I can't help but think if I had just given it to you in the first place, this whole horrible tragedy could have been avoided. I know you can't eat it now, so I'll just place it lovingly on your forehead."
"Hey, look, they got food at this thing. Here's one for the road, dude."
The music is a little, there's the iffier music in season one, especially it's just so down the middle of like, well, yeah, it's his funeral, so the soundtrack will be organs, and when Nelson enters the scene, it'll get more scary and ominous sounding.
And we also have the X's on the eyes, which we saw in, I think, Homer's Odyssey, and the bear in Burns's office had that. I think they were going for that as a conceit, like a visual conceit for death, but they dropped that quickly. It was like, this looks weird. weird on their big bulbous eyes.
They really do look weird, yeah.
It's terrifying. I'm surprised I didn't have nightmares from this when I first watched it, because I was watching it yesterday morning, and I was like, that's just a really displeasing image.
Especially if you're like a young boy watching it who sees themselves as Bart in the show, or identifies the most as Bart.
It's the biggest character, one of the most popular characters of all time. You just see him dead like that. I don't know, man.
this episode in general feels very much in the way they thought at the start of the series of Bart's the main character. This is a very Bart-y episode of the show.
It's the second one with Bart as the first word in the title.
Bart the G.
Yeah.
It actually caused me to accidentally tell you the wrong episode to do with Chris. It's just my phone auto-filled to genius instead of general.
Bart the general.
There was a good who's on first between me and Eric, because we got that when we were recording. And so me and him were like, wait, are you on genius or are you on general? Which one's general? Are you genius?
Oh, I'm even more embarrassed. I was sending you those DMs while you were in the same room.
Rename it Bart the commander.
But this dream sequence is a funny one to me, because it what it tells you about the character of Bart, of how he imagines his funeral would be, that he's like, this is how he thinks Homer would treat him at his funeral. He wouldn't really care. He doesn't imagine a joke for Marge. He just imagines that Marge would be sad.
That's the first use of special little guy, too.
You're right. Yeah. You're right.
And it's funny because a bullied kid would think when I'm dead, they'll all be sad. They'll all be crying for me. But this is a more realistic take where it's everyone's pretty indifferent about death.
I do like, you imagine and Lisa would definitely learn she should have just given me a cupcake instead of. I like to the very David Silverman style drawing of Homer's crying on the on the casket. Looked very much like Silverman's way of doing it.
That's very good animation. I like that.
And it's the funniest of all that Bart imagines that his murderer would be at his funeral to punch his corpse.
Punch him more, yeah.
The way the feet fly up on his corpse. Also that Bart doesn't know what a coroner is, so he just thinks the school nurse would doll up my eyes. And then also apparently it's being done at the school too, his funeral is. And the Skinner line of if you're right, all that homework was a waste of time. I love that. So Bart heads off to his 3:15 beating. It's a very Looney Tunes, Daffy Duck kind of moment of him hiding behind things Chuck Jonesy, even, I'd say.
Running past those bizarre children, class after class of ugly, ugly children.
But yes, then Bart gets his first beating, which every drawing of Bart's face during these punches here in this next clip is pretty great.
Put him up. Boy, you sure taught me a lesson. Whew. Thanks, guys. I guess now all that's left is a hearty handshake. Right, guys?
I'm gonna get you again tomorrow, Simpson.
Is 3:15 good for you?
Not really.
Too bad! Oh, no!
Oh, man, that guy's tough to love.
Joke added after the fact.
actually, that was a table read edition.
Okay.
In the table read script, Bart says, I hate that guy. But instead, Groening crosses it out and is written in that guy's tough to love.
Maybe it's an editing thing, but that I'll get you tomorrow, Simpson, after class. It sounds like, hello, Smithers, you're quite good at turning me on. It sounds like it was taken from five different reads of that line.
Yeah. Well, his face also looks wild in that angle, too. Nelson speaks at an angle I've never seen him do before.
It's weird. And I notice occasionally they'll draw nostrils on his pig nose, and that's a no-no. He doesn't have them.
His chin looks like the Hindenburg.
That's true.
I mean, Nelson's mouth chart is wild in general, because he's a more extreme Barney, because he has a rounder Barney head. But
do you know
that
Barney secretly is dead?
I more believe that Eddie is Ralph's father. That one I believe. Well, and also, like, not only does he look like Barney, but like he has kind of Burns's like way long overbite that it from some angles turns into like a hanging flap almost.
Yeah, and a lot of the season one characters also have like resting jutting out teeth. Like it's their standard stock pose. Just have three teeth jutting out of their face. I love it, but no new character is designed like that.
Funny that you say that because I hadn't noticed it before. But yeah, but Barney and Nelson both look like bullfrogs in the middle of a mating call.
They're inflating their sacks.
Yeah, they're getting ready for it.
We've gotten to know the Muntz family more over time, but you know, maybe this time they thought, what if he could be? Or my own guess at it right now is that, as we know, Barney gives his sperm a lot at the sperm bank, so perhaps he is, you know, a donor father to Nelson.
I can buy that.
Though, you know, it seems like Mrs. Muntz gets around a bit, or did 12 years ago or whatever when Nelson was born. Yeah, I think the reason Nelson looks so weird, and also the timing on "We'll Get You Tomorrow, Simpson," I think the reason it's all off is because they bit off more than they could chew with the scene. They wanted, like, we want one long shot of putting Bart in the trash can, threatening Bart, rolling the trash can and seeing it from the inside, and then seeing it from the outside.
Yeah, and it pulls out of the can in the same shot to see the trash can rolling away down the hill.
And that's always a danger in animation. If the longer a scene you do, the harder it is to do retakes, because you can't just be like, you have to retake the entire scene. Usually you can't just be like, retake the first 4 seconds.
Yeah,
in there.
Before digital, you couldn't just, you know, cut out a small segment and redo that.
Mm-hmm. So I can see that they were stuck with it, but the outro shot is so impressive and gutsy. Like, it's such a cool for television shot. I think it was worth it, even if you end up with a weird ass looking Nelson for like 2 seconds.
Yeah, I don't know how this looks in the Disney Plus version with its cropping, but I do like how Bart's like legs sticking up sort of frame the shot in the square frame of the television. I don't know how bad that looks when they crop it, but it's a really cool shot of him like in the trash can.
I watched it on Disney Plus. It looked fine from what I'm remembering. It looked good. But the thing is that, like, it looks great, but then I'm completely befuddled by him saying "tough to love."
Mm-hmm.
Completely befuddled.
He needs a famous Bart wisecrack.
I guess "tough to love" is more of a wisecrack than just "I hate him" or "I hate this guy."
But he should have been like, "check, please."
I would have taken that. That would have like immediately been like, what is he, his like mother or something?
it's very much a "check please" style like outro joke, like to close the scene.
It feels like a graining last panel of "From Hell" kind of joke too, which
From Hell?
It's from the Alan Moore book "From Hell." Life in Hell. Which on the scanned script too on the DVD, there's notes on there that they have of just him saying like "hell ideas, blank, blank, blank." Like it's just him like brainstorming his comic strip while
on the job.
Yeah.
At Fox.
They're not paying you for that, cartoon boy. Yeah, Bart should say like he's off my Christmas card list. There's another pitch for you.
Yeah.
Bart returns home. I think it's a very Swartzweldery touch that the trash can knows where Bart lives and ends up right at his front door.
It's more reliable than Otto.
And also a really fun drawing of Bart like tumbling out of the trash can too. And yeah, the kids, Marge and Homer, are more of their like short kind of selves, who are just like, "Ooh, Bart, what's going on?" And they just let him walk through the room.
"Hey, boy."
"Yeah, what's that, boy?" I do like Bart's line of like, "Let's just say I paid the inevitable price of helping out my sister." That's a fun line. But I ping that one on like, that sounds like a Brooks kind of line.
And like the realistic sad Bart crying in the bathtub is like, it's too much for me now to watch. It's just I don't want to see Bart this wounded. Like, between this and Bart the Genius, they're really into breaking Bart down emotionally and physically in this case.
Well, it's like the most alienating image of Bart I think I've seen. Shutting himself off in the bathroom just to get a moment alone after being decimated like that. Like, even when he gets the quivery voice in other episodes, I don't think I'm ever feeling like, oh, he's all alone.
Yeah, he's going off to cry, and you rarely hear overlapping dialogue in the show, but while Homer's talking to him in an upcoming scene, you could just hear in the background, "Aw, aw, you feel so bad."
You're right.
I mean, you're supposed to feel bad for him, but with Bart as he is now, like this just crazy character, it's so interesting to see him as a real wounded kid.
It's true. In the even in like the movie or other episodes that want you to really feel for Bart in more recent years, I think it's harder to dissociate himself from the cartoon character you've seen do all these crazy things. But in season one, it's so early, you're like, Bart wants to be alone to cry. Like, I take this as a reality, not like, and that they take the time to just do it.
Yeah, and saying literally, Dad, I need help.
Yeah.
The thing with it is that it's never like, I think back to the other moment where I really remember Bart being in pain is when the neighbor, where he has the crush on the neighbor girl, and they have that fantasy to like kind of expel it and also give you a sense of it being like, looking back and be like, it's not that bad, but like, this is totally something you remember, something hurt, something you wouldn't want anybody to go through.
It's like if the scene where Bart imagines the girl ripping his heart out and saying you won't be needing this, they instead just stayed on Bart in his treehouse and he walked into a corner and just cried.
And Homer climbed up. What's wrong, boy?
This is why you need abstraction and cartooniness and dream sequence.
And then Mo coming to knife some small boy.
Yeah, that's very strange. That's what a weird episode. They play it so, at first they play it of like, oh, Bart is hurt by being beat up, but he's just walking around like, oh, it sucks to be beaten up. Having this scene in the bathroom of just breaking down and crying and wanting to be alone, this is where like the realness comes into it. And the only thing that kind of cuts through the treacle is Bart crying in front of his dad and Homer saying, let's dry those eyes, and just blasting him in the face with a hair dryer.
Great animation, which they would later reuse on Lisa and Lisa's Pony. Yeah. I did no research for this. It was just on in the pizza pub I often work out of, and I couldn't tear my eyes away from it.
No, the drawing of it is, it's like a Stedman drawing, or a Ralph Stedman drawing, kind of just all the lines on it. It's one of my favorite drawings in the season. I'm glad they redid it for Lisa in season three for Lisa's Pony. Also, though, on the commentary, Matt Groening really hates Bart's tears there.
Yeah.
Like he's Matt Groening on a commentary. He will definitely complain about tears. But yes, Homer and Marge have different views on how to help Bart.
I had a run-in with a bully.
A bully?
Come on, Marge. I don't bug you when you're helping Lisa.
Well, Bart, I hope you're going straight to the principal about this.
I guess I could do that.
What? And violate the code of the schoolyard? I'd rather Bart die.
What on earth are you talking about, Homer?
The code of the schoolyard, Marge. The rules that teach a boy to be a man. Let's see. Don't tattle. Always make fun of those different from you. Never say anything unless you're sure everyone feels exactly the same way you do. What else?
Oh, Homer, that's ridiculous. Bart, instead of fighting, why don't you try a little understanding?
What do you mean, Mom?
Yeah, right. This ought to be good for a laugh.
Shh. This bully friend of yours, is he a little on the chunky side?
Yeah, he's pretty chunkified, all right.
And I'll bet he doesn't do well in his studies, either.
No, he's pretty dumb. He's in all the same special classes I am.
That's why he lashes out at the world.
Oh, Mark.
So tomorrow, instead of bickering with this boy, talk to him. You'll be surprised how far a little understanding will go.
Well, thank you very much, Mrs. Maharishi Gandhi. Let's go, boy.
That one sounds almost too clever for Homer, for him to be like, well, I can't call her. She's a woman, so I'll call her a feminine version of Mahatma Gandhi.
I think he's just too stupid to know the term Mahatma Gandhi, name Mahatma Gandhi.
I get, yeah, that's probably it. It almost sounds too clever for Homer that he's like, oh, I know to call her a female version of Mahatma Gandhi.
And I'm not sure if he could get through Mahatma. I feel like he'd be like, Mahuma, Mahumu, Mahuaho.
He would probably say some food stuff that sounds like Mahatma and then go, That's I think, if I can only think of one, that would have been a funnier thing I said there.
Mahat pizza.
Yeah, Mahat pizza. Okay, so Marge here, I think this is definitely Swartzwelder editorializing of like, a woman is useless in the affairs of men kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, Marge's plan wouldn't work, but I guess it's better than Homer's plan in some ways.
Yeah, I mean, both are useless. Like, I like, as we'll see when Bart tries Homer's plan, a bully is probably better than you at fighting dirty. So if you're going to start fighting dirty, all you're doing is inviting him to treat you worse when you're not going to win a fight with your bully, very likely. you're not, it's not the best move there, but it is one of those, like, another of those anti-Cliff Huxtable moments of Homer teaching Bart how to fight dirty kind of scene. So in the original script, actually, Marge gives that advice, and then Bart tries it,
It
doesn't work, and he's beaten, and then Homer gives Bart the instruction on how to fight dirty. And I feel like they would use it later, because the scene is very funny, where Bart is talking to Nelson of like, well, I know you're like fat and stupid and that must be hard for you, but I want to be your friend. And then that just gets him beaten again. Though I kind of do agree with Homer that empathizing with a bully is the thing your bully wants, and I don't think it's going to lead you anywhere helpful, I think.
Yeah, that's going to prolong your problem.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, squealing is the way to go, honestly. Like, that's your best hope in it.
Yeah, I think the real way to handle it is to just stuff it all down and wait for it to explode.
So, yeah, I think they just cut it for time to show the Marge's thing doesn't work. The joke is already there with Homer just, like, rolling his eyes at him the entire time.
Yeah, I guess we don't need to see it in practice.
Though also with, I think Groening by the end of the episode has kind of a moral objection to the might makes right message of this. So maybe he also was just like, let's cut the scene that also shows that empathy doesn't work.
Very good
point.
Maybe
we don't include that. In general, though, Homer is a really cool, like, just embodiment of the horrors of, like, twisted machismo. And this, you can see that he's never grown beyond the schoolyard psychology he was taught.
And we get this scene in the Rumpus Room, although there's no real layout for the house yet. You still have these, like, weird, like, doors upon doors in the background.
Yes, yeah.
But, like, a very oddly decorated room, which is, it's very sparse, but there are some distracting things hanging up, like this crusty scroll on the wall.
Oh, yeah.
Which I took to read after looking at it for a while, like, oh, it's like a height chart for the kids.
I think you're right. I think you're right.
But it's just this weird, like, blank pink void they're kind of in with, like, a few toys in the corner to be like, oh, no, you're in a room. You're in a room.
Yeah, I think they just saw on the script, they're like, oh, Homer takes Bart to the punching bag. And I'm like, well, where does he keep this punching
bag? Off to the punching bag room, boy.
This is kind of the sparse room where Bart, they punch a punching, well, it's not a punching bag, but in one of the shorts, it's the one of that, like, spring, the held up by a spring kind of little punching bag head that they draw Homer's face on. But this sequence of Homer, like, ripping, like, he has strong jaws, Homer, to rip up this thing with his teeth.
I'm looking at that Krusty now, very off model. They did not figure out, you see Krusty all over the place until, what, Telltale Head?
Yeah, that's when he's finally on screen.
Yeah, and when he's finally on model, like, Bart even has a Krusty lunchbox in the casket. You can barely see it.
Oh, I missed that.
Yeah, I just saw it this time. And what drives me nuts about these early background scenes are these very cartoony pictures of different family members in the scene. Just, what is that for? Like, remember Lisa? She's his sister. And there's Marge. That's his mom. Like, it's just there to remind you. I think in the shorts, they were more necessary because they were so, like, out of context and space between sketches. But here it's like, well, we just saw Lisa and Marge. I know who they are.
Mm-hmm. They're going by the rules from the shorts. The rules in the shorts were for background design, that there's photos of the family all in there, not with any rhyme or reason of just like, well, if a family member isn't in this scene, then they need to be in a photo in the background. Or like in the Christmas special, well, we're talking about Abe. We better have a picture of Grandpa behind Marge while she talks about him.
It'd be funny if they even had that in, like, the Springfield Elementary classrooms. Yeah. There's just pictures of Homer and Marge.
It's like pictures of Kim Jong-un or something. They have to hang in every room.
I'm interested in what the implication of when Homer says to Marge, like, I don't help you with Lisa. Like, that's, so it's like Homer is just fully hands off of, like, she's a girl. Talk to her with girl problems. I don't talk to her. It shows, again, a very dark relationship between Bart, Homer, and Lisa in this episode.
Is it Moaning Lisa where he's like, is this some sort of underwear thing?
Yeah. Okay. Oh, it's an underwear thing. Yeah. Well, and also it's where he's like, get on the Homer horsey. Like, it shows that Homer has no ability to deal with any emotional issues she might have. The way he deals with Bart's emotional issues are to just tell him, like, do not cry. That's his instruction.
And cheat. Do the dirtiest tricks.
No, I love that he's like, there's nothing wrong with hitting someone when their back is turned.
Oh, yeah. It's time to kick some back.
Yeah. That is, you know, you're right. That's an they embellish that more in Bart.
Brother from another planet. The same planet.
Yes,
And did we know what the family jewels were
As a kid. No way.
I didn't get it at all when I was watching this as a kid. Testicles, everybody.
Yes.
I knew because I had not the same uncle, but another uncle who really loved that. Thought that was the funniest saying out there.
I think it should have spread around these family jewels as a way to mention your testicle.
Yeah, that's one term that really just stayed in the past, family jewels.
Yeah, it never went anywhere. Although I remember it was what I like. I think it was one of the first words I used for balls because of the uncle. Like I just heard him one time say, "Oh, sat on the family jewels," and then okay.
I feel like it was the cleanest way to say balls on TV. Like Johnny Carson couldn't be like, "Oh, the family jewels," and then people would laugh at it, knowing what it was.
It's an easy. I mean, jewels sound so classy that it makes it even funnier.
It's not like balls. Bulls.
Balls. Or sack.
Nuts.
I would pay quite a lot of money to hear Johnny Carson say nutsack, though.
Oh, me too.
We missed out.
We've got a friend who knows a lot about him. I bet he could find it.
Yeah, if he ever said it. Bart tries to put into practice the cheating plan. Doesn't work out at all. The mud gets in his face. Bart gets one punch off. And, of course, Nelson is very tough and nothing goes. He just laughs it off and beats Bart all the worse. And speaking of first appearances here in this scene, first appearance of the lucky red hat.
Oh, yeah. Well, he'll cough that up a few times.
Yeah. Though this has a white bill on it, which normally his lucky red hat is drawn as fully red.
I do like that.
Which, of course, you know, red hats mean a different thing now walking the streets. But,
Bart can't wear it anymore. It means something different. And we get a nice little like thought bubble of Homer, which Bart should know that just his memory, it can't give him any new information.
It feels like a very Obi-Wan reference there too, like remember the family jewels.
Yeah, like a real use the force moment. And I like how the dream or thought bubble Homer is horrified at what he's seeing. He's just like, ooh.
That was a better way to play the scene of Bart getting beaten again, because it'd be depressing to see him get punched in the and repetitive to see him take all that punishment. So seeing Homer's reactions to it, I think is better. I don't know for sure, but I would bet that comes from a Silverman storyboard direction, because it is a very Looney Tunes, like off screen watching a horrible thing happen to a character going like, ooh,
The one thing he didn't do was like peer through his fingers, close his eyes and peer through his fingers.
And Bart's lucky recap, I love on one commentary, Mike Reese is defensive about how newer writers on The Simpsons, he once heard them making fun of it, like, oh, why don't we get Bart his lucky red cap? And he's just like, guys, I'm right here. Come on.
I think the most that ever played into a plot was an episode they can't show anymore, Stark Raving Dead.
That's true. Yeah.
It was the most offensive thing in that episode.
And I can't, all this Michael Jackson stuff coming up.
That episode was about red baseball hats and Michael Jackson, so definitely can't show it.
That's what Disney Plus said when they put out the press release. Like, this has red hats in it.
That's all. Nothing ever, other problem about it.
They got to change Mario now.
I think at least his little white circle helps.
It's more of a maroon, I would say.
So then we get introduced to Abe Simpson's, though. He had made two appearances in the Simpsons shorts, so this is not his first appearance either, just like Krusty, though. Krusty got more of a change from his shorts appearance into the series. This Abe is pretty much how he looked in the shorts.
They would change his like purple sweatery thing to a pink color.
Mm-hmm.
And so Springfield Retirement Home would become Springfield Retirement Castle. And we don't see the sign, please don't tell anyone about the outside world.
Yeah, the retirement castle turned into something much funnier by season two. Well, also, big changes from the script, too. So when Bart rolls up, which, by the way, I love the look on Lisa's face. Like,
looking at the camera, it's so great.
But when Bart rolls up and Lisa makes the suggestion to meet Abe, the joke before is Bart says, like, oh, nobody could help me. And Lisa says, you should ask Grandpa. Get the help from somebody old and wise. And Bart says, well, he is old. But so it was in some rewrite that they bring in the remember how hard we how much he fought to get him in the home. That without that rewrite, who knows how many like retirement home jokes they wouldn't have had with Abe, you know?
I guess he was independent in the shorts, an independent senior.
And also a big change for this next clip that from the script was none of this crank letter stuff was in there. It like was entirely gone.
An early trait for Grandpa they dropped, and I will say it's the third episode in a row where a character is writing a long letter. Mm. Bart the Genius has one, Homer's Odyssey has one, and this has one.
You're right.
I think they learned to stop doing this. And I think the only other time Grandpa would do this was in the front, you know, to the sickos at Modern Bride magazine. And that scene was like a fourth of the length of this one, this writing scene.
Yeah, that scene was just a setup that Abe has a typewriter. Like that's all
true.
Oh
my God, you're right. But I think after these came back and they were watching them, they're like, oh, watching a character write a letter for 45 seconds is not a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's one of many dropped season one runners, but this one was entirely born out of them being told by Fox that they couldn't say the word family jewels or shouldn't say the word family jewels.
I do like how he says horny in this. Horny!
And so when they push forward with it, they imagine like, oh, I bet we'll get angry letters from some old people. Hey, what if Abe did a whole angry letter thing? So let's give that a listen real quick here.
Dear advertisers, I am disgusted with the way old people are depicted on television. We are not all vibrant, fun-loving sex maniacs. Many of us are bitter, resentful individuals who remember the good old days when entertainment was bland and inoffensive. The following is a list of words I never want to hear on television again. Number one, bra. Number two, horny. Number three, family jewels.
Hi, Grandpa.
Oh, Bart, what brings you here?
I need some advice, Grandpa. See, there's this bully at school who keeps beating me up.
Well, let me tell you something, boy. If you don't stand up for yourself, bullies are going to be picking on you for the rest of your life.
Simpson, give me a newspaper.
Why should I?
I want to do the crossword puzzle.
No, I want to do the crossword puzzle.
I said give me that puzzle.
No.
Gimme.
No.
Gimme.
No.
And then they fight over it.
And Jasper wins. Not named Jasper yet. Mm-hmm.
But it is his first spoken word in the show. Yeah. He appeared in the background in Homer's Odyssey, but this is his first line. Pretty much how he'd always sound, I think, old Jasper there. And also the most energy he's ever had.
Well, that's the thing, is he sounds like he's full of piss and vinegar in this. But usually he kind of, I always thought of him as like the actual soft and wise one of the retirement castle.
Yeah.
And he doesn't quite have that in this scene to me.
I think he's often written to be even more senile than Grandpa sometimes.
Mm. Oh.
Yeah. Well, yeah. But also more prone to violence. Well, if it isn't the Tooth Fairy pulling a gun on him.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
And prone to paddling.
Yeah.
He likes a paddling. This whole scene with Abe, it just hit me. I think he's writing a letter to Golden Girls, actually.
Oh, yeah. Still on TV. Still
every
on TV.
Complaint he'd have could be directed at Golden Girls. But
yeah, and Fox was getting their share of letters for being the ribald network. Married with Children was the early controversy magnet, of course, before The Simpsons.
Rightly so.
Mm-hmm.
If you've ever watched some of that show, that stuff is nuts.
It's and Dan's delivery of horny.
Yeah. Bruh.
I think this is them also just realizing they love the way Dan does Grandpa's voice, and it's just hilarious.
I just remembered that the most offensive episode of Married with Children to that point that got controversy was the one in which Peggy and Kelly went out to buy a bra for Kelly.
Oh, yeah.
So that was the offending episode that caused like the one Crank to become very, very popular based on her letter writing campaign. Man,
the queen of the screwballs.
Yes. She would later inspire that episode. Yeah. So I think bra was chosen because of that.
I bet you're right.
Yeah.
I bet you're right.
For shame.
I think the offensive phrase was over the shoulder boulder holder, which I find hilarious.
Just all the old, like, that's funny with sounds. Also, right before this, the very rare use of Julie Kavner as an incidental voice as the, what was that, half of people here named Grandpa.
Third dank room on the left.
It's funny to hear it described as dank dank. What a fun, fun line. So, yes, in the original scene, it's actually about Abe's senility. He doesn't recognize Bart at first in the script.
He's
like, who are you? He's like, I'm Bart, Homer's kid. Then Abe pulls up a photograph of them in childhood, and you see Homer's face on there, and Homer is drawn to look like Bart as a child. He has Bart's hairline, it even says in the script. So by cutting that, we are safe to have a better looking old Homer than one that looks like Bart.
I'm glad they made that change.
But I mean, Homer with like brown hair, that's just perfect. I love that he used to have hair like that. And I think it makes it more connected to the hair journey that Dan Castellaneta himself went through in life.
Yeah,
too.
I mean, at this point, he was a real chrome dome, as they would call him.
Yet, I felt bad for him. Once he saw all his hair left, he's like, voice acting it is then.
Sign me up. I'll play any genie you name.
I'll never be cast in live action anything from here on.
Well, I guess it's just fathers from now on.
Hey, he was on Ink. No one remembers Ink.
I don't remember that.
I just know he was on it.
Okay. Now when I see Dan Castellaneta and stuff, I'm like, boy, you must have just really liked this script or be friends with somebody on this because you have no monetary reason to act in this thing. But yes, Abe instead, though, is ready to help Bart, but he realizes he can't help. And so this real turn of Abe taking Bart to a scary military antique store, I think it shows how much times have changed because, like, this is him radicalizing Bart around a right-wing crank, and it's not seen as weird to do that.
My crazy right-wing uncle would take me to a lot of these places as a kid. Like, he got me into weird, cool sci-fi stuff in Mad Magazine, but he was also trying to get me into guns and racism and all that stuff. And I remember being around these creeps all the time.
Yeah, you look back on your life and you're like, why did this guy own some Nazi stuff? That's weird, right?
This Target is shaped like a certain kind of person I'm seeing in this gun shop. I wonder why that is. I couldn't believe that was happening in like 1990.
An innocent time. Yes. Well, for white people who didn't want to know these things, yeah. like us.
There's a poster on the wall that says somebody talked and the planet's on fire. I could not figure that. I couldn't parse this for the life of me.
Some of these are in the script, but that one, I don't know what the deal is. The funniest one in the script to me is like Hitler teeth, 25 cents.
And there's a barely legible magazine that says Borderline Psychotic Week.
Yeah. Well, also in the script too. Yeah. Yeah. So that bit in the script is the closest thing to what I think of a Swartzwelder, like funny wall, a giant paragraph full of descriptions, you know, which they did. The background people did their best at inserting there. You know, I think maybe this showed them like, oh, we could, scenes like this really taught them of how many jokes they could stick in the corners of a background. And they pushed themselves harder to do that in season two because of these moments like this one. And I like too that Abe, they don't say Abe is a World War II vet like fully in this episode, but I think you're led to believe that he is a veteran of some foreign war in this one, for sure.
Yeah, I think that a lot of this is about the odd relationship between Vietnam vets and World War II vets, which you would see play out a lot in media in the 90s.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. I think especially when Bart says you lose your arm in the war, Bart does mean Vietnam when he says the war, yeah. Yes, we meet Herman for the first time. Much like Otto, another character they thought would be sticking around.
He's only used when they need someone sleazier than Mo. I think he would be seen again for the next time when he was operating the jeans ring out of the car hole.
I think that was like his last big one. He sells the fez to Abe in Old Money. That's the last time they were really palling around. Like, yeah. Herman and Abe should be hanging out all the time. Have some more Herman and Abe scenes.
And then, of course, in the Pulp Fiction parody.
Oh, God. Yes. Yeah. I mean, that's fitting for who Herman is, but and that shows you what they think of John Swartzwelder when they're like, oh, Herman's you. Like, we think you're Herman.
They were like, which character do we not need to use ever again? Herman.
When he says when he's trying to sell them Nazi underwear, do you think that's like underwear with a swastika on it or actual underwear worn by the Nazis?
I took it to mean, and now I read it as not underpants with swastikas on it, but I think it was meant to be undergarments worn by Nazi soldiers.
Yeah.
I just had this very weird image in my head of Abraham Simpson in his like white shirt and suspenders and having like these bright red swastika boxer shorts, and it freaked me out through this whole episode.
Oh, Jesus. I think it was like a reference to I mean, no one in my family fought in the big one, the great one, the second great one, but I know like a lot of soldiers would just bring home anything, helmets and pins and medals and stuff, whatever they could find on the battlefield.
I mean, yeah, like grandpas of our age, you'd think of them having like some gold swastika, and they're like, yeah, I saved this from the guy I murdered to remind me of the guy I killed or of liberating town X. But then you'd have guys like Herman who you're like, why do you own all this Nazi stuff? But yeah, I like that. I think Abe just befriends Herman because Abe still recalls his youth with all this military stuff, but the only person he knows who's interested in it is a right-wing crank like Herman, who in this scene is voiced to be H.W. Bush, too.
Makes total sense. Is it.
What's the password?
Let me in, you idiot.
Right you are.
So, Herman, has the large type edition of this month's Soldier Fortune come in yet?
Not yet. Can I interest you in some authentic Nazi underpants?
No! Actually, we came over because I want you to meet my grandson, Bart.
Ah. Hello, young American.
Hello, sir. Mr. Herman?
Yes?
Did you lose your arm in the war?
My arm? Well, let me put it this way. Next time your teacher tells you to keep your arm inside the bus window, you do it.
Yes, sir. I will.
Bart's got a problem with a local young bully named Nelson. I thought you could help him with some kind of strategy.
Strategy? How many men do you have?
None.
You'll need more. And you'll need to train them hard. Now, let's see.
It's weird to hear Bart be oddly deferential to this weird adult. Like, I feel
that's
like
true.
He should say, like, cool amputee, man, or whatever. Like, how'd you lose your arm, man?
You're right. Yeah, this is more reserved than Bart has played like, in pretty much any scene.
Excuse me, sir. I have a question.
And, like, you would think he'd be, like, interacting with more of the stuff around him. Like, why would you have this?
Mm-hmm. Bart holding a gun or an unexploded grenade or something.
Or holding something really inappropriate and going, cool.
Yeah. But this is the more realistic way of playing a kid who is, like, terrified that his grandpa taking him to a weird place. I mean, this side of grandpa who regularly reads Soldier of Fortune, that went away. That doesn't fit in with just the cuddly old coot grandpa that we know.
The large print edition.
That's funny, but... Soldier of Fortune is a fucked up magazine.
Yes.
That's why they have the line there that it's one of those red flags that if you see that like on someone's coffee table, you're like, I gotta get out of here. He's gonna hunt me for sport.
I don't know. I think those like doomsday prepper magazines are much more scary.
Well, they're scarier magazines.
They've
now.
Only gotten worse. That was like the most scary magazine in 1989.
And also a real Simpson-y callback there, you know, in Homer's Odyssey, Bart was warned to not put his arm outside the bus window because you'd lose your hand or arm. And so that's the payoff there of Herman saying that's how it happened.
I guess Herman was the original Joker because he was supposed to have a different story every time someone asked him about
his arm.
So he's the original Joker.
All these jokers, man. But yes, Bart then gets told the strategy he needs to do, which is build an army to attack this bully, which this is also the moment where the Patton music comes in and the Patton score is played as the references begin to it.
So really the first direct parody of something like super specific in the show?
I think so. You know, in No Disgrace Like Home, Marge sings a song that Dean Martin sang, and it's kind of staged like it would have been on a Dean Martin-like television special, but it's not like a one-to-one. This was in Dean Martin, but in No Disgrace Like Home, they do One of Us, One of Us.
Ah, that's from that episode, yeah. Yeah, so... Yeah.
Okay, that, but this is a much more prolonged one.
Yeah, using the music. I mean, and then later we have that famous Life Magazine picture parody, yeah, which I'll talk more about later.
Well, it's also, you could just imagine Swartzwelder both loves the movie Patton and probably has a tattoo of Patton on his back.
And I've never seen Patton, but I think all you need to know is like a guy talks in front of a flag briefly, and then that's all you really need to take from that movie.
That's the main thing. I've seen it. I love it. But it is... Coppola, I think, wrote it, and he was supposed to direct it, but then somebody else took it, but it still looks really good. Everybody always takes the American flag thing, and I'm like, this one at least is doing something else with it.
You're right. I guess he never does that. There's no character that does that.
There's no Bart speech. Actually, if you remember, there's that one commercial for The Simpsons that came a few years later where they literally draw The Simpsons into Fox movie scenes. And one of them is Bart in front of the big flag. They also like draw him over Luke in the trench run of the Star Wars. So they eventually did do it, but...
I mostly know Patton from Mystery Science Theater references. Mm. Like, when you stick your hand into a pile of goo, then you'll know.
I don't know about any scene in Patton after the opening speech by George C. Scott.
It's a good one, and yeah. I love George C. Scott. But yeah, very specific Patton parodies. This is where the episode loses me a bit, because after I grew up and was not obsessed with Bart, the joke really is kids doing adult war things, and that it doesn't really go beyond that. There's some fun commentaries about war that I like, and I wish there was more of. They didn't need to try as hard back then because it was just so much of a novelty to see this. But now, just like, I feel like there could be so much more happening here. And this montage that's coming up is 2 minutes long.
Way too long.
Yeah.
Proto Rugrats again, I'd say, too.
I mean, I feel like a lot of this is this might be parts of Swartzwelder's actual diaries that just came into this, like the Greeks and the Carthaginians or whatever the fuck.
Yeah. The tension in this third act is that, as Swartzwelder wrote it, it's just about Bart learning to militarize to defeat his bully. And then you have Matt Groening's reaction to reading that and adding in lines, like I'll show you where lines were changed up to be more of a commentary on warfare. But I think in general, I think Groening wasn't happy with the tone of the third act. So that's why there's some more scenes that were like, hey, you know, these are some problems with war. War is not good.
And we're on the cusp of like Desert Storm.
Oh, yeah.
At this time in history.
Bart's going to be on a lot of t-shirts soon. Oh, written in Saddam Hussein.
If you're at our live show, you saw some of them.
I also love that when Herman says, like, it's right here on Elm Street, he just has a knife right there in his hand. Like, that should be scaring Bart, that he has a knife so easily handy. So also this Patton moment was when the music starts coming in. It's another of those moments I've had watching Simpsons in the Disney years of realizing, like, yeah, the Simpsons used that song because Fox owned the movie and they wouldn't have to pay extra for the film rights. Thus meaning this song is from a Disney movie now and Patton is owned by Disney. Like, it's just another to add to the list of films Disney owns now.
Well, that's if you were using Disney Plus more, you know, it's up on the main thing. That's when you turn on, it's Mandalorian, then Patton, and then The Simpsons.
And I guess we don't need to say this, but Patton Oswalt's named after Patton,
yes,
the general.
Yeah. very different in spirit from him, but yeah. That's, his father had different plans for his son there. In the script, it's interesting, they wanted to do like more obvious song choices. Not that Patton's like not an obvious song choice, but they had, like, you know, War, What Is It Good For, and also like Doors songs from Apocalypse Now, like that's written in the script of, like, we could try this. Like, I'm kind of glad you don't hear Patton music in a lot of war parodies and things. You do hear just the same old War, What Is It Good For bullshit, or Fortunate Son, or one of a million of the obvious things.
The Forrest Gump soundtrack.
Yeah, all the Forrest Gump soundtrack.
That's a double disker.
That was how my friend, his favorite album for the longest time was just the Forrest Gump soundtrack, like just as the boomer playlist.
That is grotesque. I was like that with the Gross Point Blank soundtrack.
I think Pulp Fiction was a soundtrack. Mallrats was the one I listened to the most. I listened to that over and over and over.
I sure love the band Squirt Gun, who did the opening song for Mallrats and then nothing, I guess.
Oh, yeah, yeah. A skeleton in a suit and tie tells us what we ought to buy.
Oh, man, the lyrics are blowing my mind.
A bag of cocaine into your heart. Support your conscience. That's a start.
When I listen to that song, I'm like, can they say this? I bought that CD for like $18 in 1997. What a ripoff.
The song by Squirt Gun has been redacted. It will no longer be shown.
I think that even came with a poster, too, or like a fold-out.
The Magic Eye poster, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, we apologize for this.
This the Kevin Smithness, we got to stop. We could go on all day about Kevin Smith movies. So they then come back from break. Bart is in his treehouse after telling all the kids to meet him at 3 o'clock or at 1500 hours. And Bart is late for it. I think this is the first scene in Bart's treehouse, too, even counting the shorts. I don't think they went in there.
And I think part of the unspoken joke that they would just maybe pave over later is that the treehouse is shitty. It's bad. It's just a poorly made treehouse.
Because Homer's bad at building. You're right. Yeah. I didn't even get that. That's the joke. Yeah.
And it's also like a clown car. Like you can fit as many people as possible.
That's true. Yeah. There's like 30 kids up there. But I think it's just like everything is in the background is just not drawn very well. So it's hard to communicate. Like, what does a poorly built structure look like in this season? Yeah.
Yeah. And there's also a green shirted poster of Krusty behind him, too. And yes, they say Bart is late, which, again, is a joke. I don't think they fully got through, but he said to meet at 3, he's beaten at 3:15 every day, so that's why he's late. He comes out and coughs out his hat to explain he was being beaten, but the time is part of the joke, too.
Okay. It's a really nice understated joke that he comes in, coughs up his hat, and hangs it up.
That's
but
great.
His hat is not there in the background after that, so I think the joke is just lost because you don't see the hat anymore. I think I noticed it for the first time this time that he like just gingerly hangs his hat up and turns around to address everybody.
There should just be a cut scene. I don't even need to be in an episode. Maybe a dream sequence if you want. But just a 5-second clip of Bart getting up one day and just before he does anything else, swallowing his hat.
Practicing his hat swallowing abilities. I mean, it's pretty impressive that he can swallow it fully whole and spit it back
out. And his body doesn't break it down in any way.
And I mean, if it's a flat brim, that's just going to be trouble for your lungs.
Oh, God.
Yeah, he needs to start curving that brim. Then Bart learns the best way to get an army's loyalty is to lie to them and promise them victory. Very, very smart on Bart's case. And then begins the training montage, including the show's first Kubrick montage or Kubrick reference as well. Though it's a real mix of things. It's like it's Patton music but then the training stuff from Full Metal Jacket and then a couple shots from like The Longest Day.
The shot of like the helmet in the foreground and the kids marching in the backgrounds from The Longest Day is the shot of Bart like chewing on the like piece of hay and the reflection of the soldiers in his glasses. Is that from Patton too? Because I was looking for screenshots of Patton. Patton wore sunglasses, I have to assume. But it also was like, is this also Cool Hand Luke in some ways?
You know, actually, maybe it is more cool. I read it as a Patton scene, but again, I haven't seen the film.
I'm pretty sure, yeah. I wanted to watch it for this, but this is a very busy week for us. But I just have to assume. And the Patton content in this is so late.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I highly recommend you watch it. It is a very good movie. But I think it is, he was always with a cigar, though, I feel.
Well, he can't put a cigar in Bart's mouth, though.
Oh, so yeah, that's probably what it is, actually.
Okay, yeah, so I guess they can't make Bart smoke.
Not yet. He'll smoke in season 2.
Yeah, in that episode with Nelson's Ha-Ha, right?
Yeah. Nelson's Ha-Ha. Yeah. It just sounded funny the way he said it. It's, for the Full Metal Jacket one, it's not just the, drill instructor and the running shot, which... You know, they did their best, but it's a very complicated shot in live action to compose to then get it done in season 1 Simpsons animation. Like, they're going to falter in that.
There's a much better version of this in Sweet Seymour Skinner's Badass Song, where he's like correcting the troop for saying a filthy rhyme.
Yeah, that is a better scene. I do like, though, them all climbing on the jungle gyms, like up and down with the, you know, where it's a silhouette over orange. That's a really good pull of a less used shot from Full Metal Jacket.
That's true.
People were used.
Then a fairly recent movie.
It was less than 3 years old. It was June 87 it came out.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't even think of that. Yeah, that's really weird.
That's like The Simpsons now in a 2020 episode making fun of a 2017 movie or recreating that. Like, it's that recent. Like how I felt when I watched I think like 2 or 3 years after The Departed came out, they did a full parody episode of The Departed, The Departed.
That's right, yeah.
And that felt too recent, but here they are doing it in season one with a, look, in my defense, The Departed also constantly plays the Dropkick Murphys song from The Departed as well, so there's reasons to like it less.
How long after Get Out came out did they get onto that one? I wonder. That seems like one they would jump right on.
You know, it wasn't in this year's Treehouse. They didn't do a Get Out.
That's got to be an upcoming one. They can't really ignore it.
They did Stranger Things this season. They did that one.
But I think Us might be a safer parody for them than Get Out.
Yeah, that's true. That's absolutely true.
Yep. Yeah.
And there's more crazy, insane logic in that movie than there is in Get Out.
That, yeah, I think is safer. Let's go with the safer bit of
yeah.
Us.
Yeah. There are so many more questions that need to be answered by Us in the upcoming Us trilogy.
That was a real, that movie didn't make the same impact as Get Out, but I really liked Us a lot as well. I can't believe Lupita Nyong'o didn't get nominated, though. Like, that was, when I saw the movie, I was like, this is an Oscar easy right here.
I mean, it was a lot of burp talking, but I enjoyed it.
Well, that's, I mean, if you, this could turn this whole podcast just into me yelling, but
I want to hear this.
I love Us. I think it's just as good as Get Out. I think it's a wilder and opener movie. I think it's a movie that you can only make after you've made a hit movie. It's kind of we've been on the Blank Check podcast, that it is a Blank Check movie, if you and the fact that Nyong'o didn't get it is ridiculous, because I forget who, like, I like Renee Zellweger and everything, but that Judy performance, it's like so just the boilerplate of every other musical artist that's being played by a very good actor that I'm just like, I don't care.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't be Oscar nominations if they didn't nominate somebody for doing an impression of a famous person.
Yeah, like Freddie Mercury.
It just kills me.
Us is very fun, and it was like a fun ride, and I actually had fun like taking apart like the very weird reality of the movie that just raises further questions, as Hermes would say.
And the acting in it is just so great. Winston
Tim Heidecker.
Yeah.
Tim Heidecker's really good.
This is the Us cast.
I guess we could just cut it off by saying the Oscars made a mistake in nominating someone. That's crazy.
Never happened.
Never. But yes, the training montage goes on a very long time, but
over 2 minutes.
There is an interesting bit here with Bart and one of his recruits.
What's the matter with you, soldier?
It's my nerves, sir. I just can't stand the barking anymore.
Your nerves? I won't have cowards in my army.
Sorry, Bart. You can push them out of a plane. You can march them off a cliff. You can send them off to die on some godforsaken rock. But for some reason, you can't slap them. Now, apologize to that boy right now.
Sorry, man.
That's cool.
In English class, I did the best.
Yeah, so in the original script, Bart slaps the kid and Abe just tells him, you apologize, that he says like, hey, you can't do that, and he slaps Bart back. So that entire run of about all the irony of war, that you can't slap your recruit but you can make him die,
and how the rules of war just make no sense.
Yeah, that was a late addition that I'm gonna also think is probably graining.
I think Mac Groening realized far too late they were making a pro-war episode
starring their main character. One, like, hey, Bart says war is cool, guys.
He says war is cool, man.
Oh, yes.
I think there is also a scene in Patton where he slaps one of his soldiers.
Oh, okay.
I'm pretty sure. It's been a little while since I've seen it, but I have the image in my mind.
You know, I think comedy parodists out there, they should be using this Patton soundtrack more often, like the just the da-da-da-da-da-da. It's catchy. It's memorable. But
I don't know if we have the cultural knowledge of Patton anymore.
Oh, not at all.
Yeah.
No. You hear those things, no one thinks, oh, that old movie Patton I love. We all it was an Oscar winner, that movie, though, like a Best Picture.
Yeah, 1970. I like Grandpa's line here in his later one with Herman, but it feels like just a long monologue where it's not very clever. What it's saying is interesting and makes a lot of sense, but it just feels like, okay, shine a spotlight on Grandpa to do his anti-war thing, and we're done.
Now, that is why it feels like a graining, like, big speech balloon, really, is what it feels like.
Like, I feel like it should be couched in a story of something that happened to him in a war or something like that, not just like, here are the things you can do and can't do.
The kid in there, just imagine that's Milhouse. When you hear the voice, that is Milhouse's voice. But
it really is.
It isn't Milhouse, but it should be. And speaking of funny drawings, I wish I'd put it in our good animation montage at the live show. The dog they run by is so crazy and fun looking. I love, he's just like this rectangle that just bounces up and down.
Not in the universe of that show.
No. He's better than the police dog that we saw in No Disgrace Like Home, the one Eddie and Lou bring into the bar. Like, that's a wackier, like, cartoony dog. I like this boxy dog. He's a fun boxy dog. Herman is called in to help, and that's where he, like, brings his bayonet in and stabs it, which I think Bart's lesson really should have been to hire Herman to stab Nelson.
To murder Nelson. To murder a boy.
At least threaten to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, get a motel room, bring him in, put the money on the bed, tell him where he is. Very easy.
Yeah.
Both Homer and Herman, they both maul an effigy of Nelson in this episode.
Yeah, it is a double joke there. Maybe only do one of those.
This is a good exaggeration of that, though, where he's just like gutting him.
That he brought in his probably original, like, 1917 bayonet to stab it. Also, here's another funny one from the OG script when they are planning out their strategy of like, oh, Nelson is here, we're going to go attack him. They say in it, oh, the reports are at he's at the video arcade, which that is such an 80s way of saying arcade. They just like the video arcade.
It's not Noiseland yet.
But the original script line, I love it and wish it was in there. He says, reports are in that Nelson's at the liquor store buying candy.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
That's a great line. I wish they'd kept it in there.
And we have not seen the Quickie Mart yet, but in this little model of the town, there's the Quickie Mart, and they mentioned the Quickie Mart, but it's spelled Q-U-I-C-K instead of K-W-I-K. So I didn't figure that out quite yet.
I wonder if it was... Yeah, I guess they won't go into the Quickie Mart until Telltale Head. So it might have just been either they changed their mind after they did this one, or just a miscommunication to the background animators that it's not with it's with a Q instead of a K. That's when Abe has another rather lengthy speech in this scene here.
Nelson's at the Elm Street Video Arcade.
Intelligence indicates he shakes down kids for quarters at the arcade. Then he heads to the Quickie Mart for a cherry squishy.
And that's where we'll hit him. When he leaves the Quickie Mart, we start the saturation bombing. We got the water balloons.
200 rounds, sir. Is it okay if they say happy birthday on the side?
Well, I'd rather they say death from above, but I guess we're stuck. Okay, our main force will be split into two groups. One will circle around this way to cut off the enemy's retreat. The other will drive in this way, closing the trap. It's a classic pincers movement. It can't fail against a 10-year-old.
Nelson's at the arcade, General.
Battle station.
I feel so alive.
You know, I thought I was too old. I thought my time had passed. I thought I'd never hear the screams of pain or see the look of terror in a young man's eyes. Thank heaven for children.
I always laugh when they cut to Herman nodding. They just need a shot of something else.
And it's a very weird insert.
Yeah, just like, mm-hmm.
Herman agrees.
But yeah, we were recently on the cusp of war, and old men love sending young men to die.
Yeah, it's true.
It gets them horny, yeah. I think.
It is a good opposite of how you expect a speech to be. Like, a maudlin show would have a speech by a World War II vet saying, like, I'm so glad today's kids grow up in a world of peace. peace and they don't need to know the pain of bloodshed. Like, this is Abe complaining that kids don't die anymore and soon they will.
Yes. So. Well, we had a good decade after this of no nice. War.
Pretty nice.
Or very little war. Just fun secret wars.
Yeah, sure, we were bombing people, but like, we didn't have to think about it.
No problems whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. Also, I did want to mention just Elm Street in general is such a, it's an obvious line. Like, it's just like every place has an Elm Street, but they don't use it much any after this. When I searched on Frankiac for any other use of the word Elm Street, and it was just used as a descriptor by Marge for the location of the sushi restaurant in Blowfish.
Interesting. Okay, yeah. So Elm Street was a thing.
Yeah, she'd say the new sushi restaurant that opened on Elm Street. That's the line. But that was the only one that came up in my Frankiac search. I don't think anything else. Usually it just became Evergreen Terrace, which wasn't originally where the Simpsons lived on. It was just a street name said. But over time, it just turned into the only street in Springfield worth mentioning. The balloon saying happy birthday. That's a good joke, too. I do like that. So, yes, Nelson and his weasels get ambushed.
Hey, good squishies.
What flavor did you get?
Blue.
Hey, you two birds. You're going to be sucking all your meals through straws if you don't shut your traps.
Well, looky here. Little Bart Simpson.
Nelson, I'm afraid I'm going to have to teach you a lesson.
Ha! Oh, yeah? You and what army?
This one.
Artillery! Commence saturation bombing!
And the saturation is a joke. It's the water saturating people. But,
Oh, yeah.
And that's the first reference to squishies, too, which I like that the flavor is blue. That's a funny line.
Yeah, like I grew up in the Midwest where there were no 7-Elevens. So now whenever I go to one, I went to my first one when I was like in my 20s. Whenever I go to one and see Slurpees, I think of squishies because that's what introduced me to the concept of the fun, like Slurpee squishy drink.
Yeah, I didn't have. We had like Icy's.
Icy's we had in Ohio.
Oh yeah, my town Icy's too. No slushies. Yeah.
No, and I also when 7-Elevens came to New York City, all of a sudden I was like a whole new world because I used to get that stuff at like gas stations.
Oh, I think 7-Eleven like upscaled it a little bit from what you expected from a gas station, though. Well, I'll tell you what, the regional one I've been always jealous of not having is Wawa.
Oh yeah,
I've never been to a Wawa.
Sheets is good too. Sheets.
Oh, I should check that out too. Yeah. If I'm ever in the East Coast, which I never am ever. One of these days we'll do a live show in like Boston or something. New York City is the only place in the, you know, Northeast I've ever been to. It's so it's still a magical world to me of like Wawa's with them hoagies.
We have another fun Nazi reference too.
Oh boy.
The weasels.
The weasels say the Nazi line of we were just following orders.
And the children immediately embrace them as they turn on Nelson.
So in the original script, they don't say that line. They just say like, oh, we want to join you guys now. And they're like, oh, okay. And then the weasels say, isn't it good to be on the winning side? And then they start throwing balloons too.
Is that like a direct quote from the Nuremberg trials? I'm sure it was said many times.
It's what it was a stereotype of what Nazis said, and certainly no other army would say that in defense of anything. Only Nazis. Yeah,
it's true.
No.
But to put those words into the mouths of kids, I mean, all these Nazi reference in here, I think it feels like in 1990 we're like, oh yeah, they'll never be Nazis again. What an old silly thing to make fun
Tell
of.
All the Hitler jokes you want.
Mm-hmm, nonstop. Also, Nelson's grunts of pain throughout here, they don't sound like the noises Nancy normally does for like Nelson pain. They're like, ugh. It's just all kind of over the place.
Well, he's drowning. That's why.
I guess so.
It's going into his lungs.
I mean, also, Nelson, I would think that Nelson, even as he's portrayed in this, the fifth time that water balloon hit him, he'd run towards the people throwing them and start punching them all in the face and beat the shit out of them. But he just kind of accepts like, oh, by being hit by these water balloons, I am immobile. I mean, that's how it works better for the plot, so that's why they do it. But
I have a bit to say about the parody of the famous Life magazine photograph, if you want to get to that.
Yeah, yeah. So they capture Nelson, and it's time to celebrate, right? Yeah.
Right. So it's very strange in which you can now reference memes on TV shows, but I think you can no longer reference famous photographs or even paintings. I think those are all just like lost to time. But this is a very famous World War II photograph taken on VJ Day, Victory Over Japan Day. And I have a great story that's kind of creepy. So the guy in the photo kissing the nurse, it was George Mendoza, who just died in February of last year at age 95.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Damn.
And the story from The Guardian is, there was many stories written about him when he died, but the story from The Guardian says, Mendoza was on leave and had been on a date with another woman when he heard the war was over. His date, Rita Petrie, is seen in the background of the photo. So you can see his date in the background while he's kissing another woman. She said she didn't mind that he kissed another woman amid the celebration. In fact, she became his wife of 7 decades. And the quote from her was, "Either I was dopey or something, but it didn't bother me," she told CBS, adding that he would sometimes repeat the performance. Quote, "It'll come up that he's the kissing sailor. So the kissing sailor has to think he has to kiss everybody. So he does." They eventually found the woman he kissed. And basically, it's like, this guy just grabbed me and kissed me. I was on a break from my job. I didn't really like it.
No, it's harassment.
Yeah, and she was an older lady from the generation. I don't know if she had the language of modern feminism to work with, but it did seem like, well, you sexually assaulted that woman in the street and several others. But he's in hell now. But thanks for saving our country. Listen, you can't sexually assault 5 women in the street and then go to heaven. I'm sorry. There are standards.
I feel like that sounds fair.
Yeah.
That sounds fair. No, that's...
I just have this image of him going into, like, McDonald's and, like, ordering and then saying, "Hey, fellas, if I give... you know who I am. I'm the guy from the VJ picture. How about if I give my wife here a smooch? How about, can I get some free fries?"
If I do it in a photo for you guys in front of McDonald's, I'll get a Happy Meal, right?
I mean, did anyone try to make out with strangers when Osama bin Laden was killed?
I'm sure somebody assaulted somebody on that day.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, and 100%. I guess the attitude was like, "Oh, you know."
Yeah. Why, in 1940? What? Especially to a man in uniform. What are you gonna say other than like, "Oh, you"?
It just is like, it's a very famous photo, but just like, well, he just kind of grabbed the random ladies like and smooched her.
Yeah, Lisa has the correct response.
Yeah.
Also, she could have reported him to, like, the authorities, but at the very least, a slap and, like, "Ew, knock it off." Like, that's what that nurse should have done back in the day. I think that has damaged the legacy of that photograph being a famous one. Yes,
and that it was one of many women he did that to that day, that time, while his girlfriend is in the background. What a creep.
Yeah, the girlfriend who became wife in the background, that is the craziest revelation from that to me.
I guess they tracked them down in like 1980
when
they were doing like a retrospective on the war.
And that was the time to just brag, and nobody wanted to hear the sad parts of it. Only in the modern era were they like, "Hey, wait a minute. So you forced yourself on a woman, huh? Oh, that's weird."
I mean, can't you just say he was a good kisser? Come on, we're trying to write something here for Big J.
We need a silver lining to the sexual assault.
I would think the Time magazine editor just cut that out of his original reporting. Like, "Oh, she said she didn't accept that kiss, or he didn't know her and was a stranger. Forget that. Let's not talk about that.
Let's just keep the whole section of us dropping bombs in Hiroshima."
Yeah, that's easy.
It's more pleasant.
I have two more things to mention that were changed big from the script. One is, right after the war's over, they have a scene that is totally unneeded where Abe says, "Well, I got to go. War's over now. You beat him. I have to go home." And then he says, "If I'm late, they'll declare me dead and collect my pension." And so they cut that from the episode, but save it to use in Bart versus Thanksgiving in season 2.
Oh, I thought I had heard it before. Yeah, I do like that joke.
Yeah, Homer, when Abe leaves Thanksgiving, he doesn't say pension, he says, "Collect my insurance." But he's like, "I gotta leave now. If I don't, the home will declare me dead and collect my insurance." So at least they saved a good line they cut, even this early in the show. And then the realization that Bart can't leave Nelson tied up forever, it takes 5 pages. Like, it's really long in the original script. A mistake, really.
Yeah, things really zoom to an end here after this little tie-up game,
like
as Marge calls it.
Yeah, like in the original script, Bart's like, oh, you can't just leave me tied up forever. Oh, yeah? And then, like, time cut, 4 hours pass. Time cut, it's nighttime now. Time cut. They even have in the script Mr. and Mrs. Muntz commenting on, where's our kid? Like, so.
And the wagon is just full of piss.
yeah, so I think they realize, like, let's just cut to the chase and realize we need the treaty. The treaty is still there in the original script, but they cut to it way faster. As Bart makes a deal with Nelson.
I guess you learned your lesson, so now I'll untie
you. The second you untie me, I'm gonna beat you to death, man.
Well, if that's gonna be your attitude, I'm not gonna untie you.
Ha! You're gonna have to sometime.
Uh-oh. He's right.
Don't you worry. I was ready for this little eventuality. Armistice Treaty Article 4. Nelson is never again to raise his fist in anger. Article 5. Nelson recognizes Bart's right to exist. Article 6. Although Nelson shall have no official power, he shall remain a figurehead of menace in the neighborhood.
Wow, sounds good to me. Okay, I'll sign.
What about you, boy?
All right, I'll sign.
Are you boys through playing war?
Yeah.
Yes, Mrs. Simpson.
Good. Then here's some cupcakes.
Oh, boy.
Mmm. Cupcakes.
Mm. Oh. Lemonade. Thanks. Yes, please.
Yeah, I did remind you of that, yeah. And that right to exist thing, obviously, in Israel, pull. Very complicated, a lot of baggage there. Can't go into it now.
Yeah, we've already gone 2 hours. Yeah, let's talk about Israel's history for another two.
But another just noisy TV blaring a cowboy show in the background. Mm-hmm. Like, I think, like, the third instance of this.
I think this also wasn't in the original script, but in the posing there where Homer says, what about you, boy? I feel like there's an implicit threat with Homer. There, just like, huh? You gonna do it? That's why Nelson finally signs, that Homer backs up a threat for him.
It's a fun reveal of just Nelson on the couch watching TV with Homer and Lisa,
but still tied up.
Yeah, still tied up.
And also in the original script, the thing that gets him to agree isn't Homer saying that, but being offered $7, and they call it like reparations, not bribery. Mm. And that's the joke in there. Yeah, I like that Nelson's like, yes, Mrs. Simpson. And when the cupcakes come back in, which that the original end of the script is that they eat cupcakes and then the music plays. So that's why I wanted this clip to end there, too. So you can see, like, this was the original ending of the episode.
Okay.
And bringing back the cupcakes is a real bookend of, like, now everybody gets to have their cupcakes and they're all happy.
This non-Alf Clausen composer likes to end the show reminding you're watching The Simpsons.
Mm, yeah.
Because, like, his episodes end with, like, dun, 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 dun.
I mean, it makes sense.
Yeah.
It makes sense as just as a branding thing.
Subtle. I think Alf Clausen would do similar things, but not as just like brassy and in your face.
Yeah,
I mean, it's early on too. I mean, it's super. I mean, this early on, I feel like you have to do that.
Yeah, yeah. I welcome the Alf Clausen years with his more subtle choices and unexpected places he went to. But no offense to Richard Gibbs. This has become like this. This revisiting of season one has really been trashing Richard Gibbs a lot on
We're
my part.
But. Going easier on Klasky Chupo, harder on Gibbs.
But that was not to be the real ending, as this is the best part of the script that's on the DVD, is that Matt Groening in the writer's room at the table read on the back of his page, just in cursive, wrote this entire last scene of the episode. Pretty much verbatim as Bart says it in the episode.
Yeah, I was surprised. I was actually scanning through it too, and I saw that, and I was like, this is just what he says.
Yeah, yeah.
And he had the executive power to make it happen, to add this addendum to the show, which shortened the title, probably cost more money to give them more animation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was. I think it was probably a retake anime or a late addition for sure. It's one I welcome. I mean, yes, is it a little like, you know, PSA or, you know, the more you know kind of moment that is not as smart as The Simpsons would be, sure, but I think it's necessary with, especially if you come from like the peacenik, hippie ethical background of Groening, he couldn't imagine the show going out without Bart saying that.
On the commentary 11 years later, they're laughing at how sweaty and contradictory this is. And like, well, that takes care of that.
Yeah, that's true. It's like, well, then you're right. In that case, it's like, Well, I mean, then don't do an entire episode of Aggrandizing War to just stick on 30 seconds of saying it's
actually
not
it's bad.
Yeah, that's
I
true.
Mean, you have to imagine that Swartzwelder's like first idea was to just put like the entirety of Red Dawn at the end of it.
Yeah, he should be celebrating our Mujahideen fighters at the end of the episode.
Nelson dies in his draft, his original draft.
Bart just shoots him in the face at the end of the episode.
Ooh, that'll get some letters.
let's just play the moral of the story.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, contrary to what you've just seen, war is neither glamorous nor fun. There are no winners, only losers. There are no good wars, with the following exceptions: the American Revolution, World War II, and the Star Wars trilogy. If you'd like to learn more about war, there's lots of books in your local library, many of them with cool, gory pictures. Well, good night, everybody. Peace, man.
Mm-hmm. Gets a little undercut by Patton music coming back in.
That's true. A simpler time when there was only a Star Wars trilogy.
Oh, yeah. Yep. Oh. That hurt us more than thinking about real life wars. Yeah. Just thinking about new Star Wars films.
You can see what our priorities are.
I do like the energy of Bart saying, you know, there are no good wars and peace, man. Like, I like that messaging on a TV show. Oppositely, I think it is really clunky to have Bart just earnestly say, go to your local library and read more books about it. Like,
I guess the cool, gory pictures is a nice subversion on that, but it's still like, hey, like, go out and do research to find out why war is bad.
Well, it's basically what He-Man would say to you at the end of something, too. But he wouldn't even have an anti-war message that light. Like, because Bart can't even be just fully anti-war. He has to say the accepted caveat that most Americans then would have agreed to, like, well, no, there were at least two good wars, World War II and the American Revolution. There aren't only losers in war.
I think civilians would disagree with what he said.
In 1990, I'm sure in 1990 some people, though, were still like, Vietnam was a good war. It was just this bullshit kid on TV saying it was wrong.
Turn off this yellow filth.
Yeah, the last thing I'll say is that Silverman on the commentary says they thought they might just reuse that for a bunch of scenes of just like Bart doing commercials and just saying whatever they need him to say in reusing those shots, which I think they did do in a few early commercials, but it didn't repeat for very long. It's an easy setup of Bart dangling his feet, like Bart sitting in a library and mouth moving. That could work for a million commercials for Nancy Cartwright to say, like, watch Drexel's class next or whatever.
I see it as more of a Herman's Head vehicle.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
But Chris, thanks for sticking with us for so long. Can you please let us know your final thoughts on this one?
I really like this one, especially because I've just been going through the first season since getting Disney Plus. Not to give them too much press here, but I have been going through it. And this one is one that sticks with me because there are a lot of big images in it, like Bart alone in the bathroom, like the Full Metal Jacket reference with them going over things. Like it was one of the first ones, and the noise, the Patton score. I thought that was them at first when I was younger. And all those little things was like, it was the first one that really locked in for me, I think. I still love it.
This is a fun episode that also has the animation more together than in the previous four. I think this is the second one Silverman directed, so it must be like another round of animation deliveries so he can learn from some of the stuff that's starting to come in.
You can tell he's getting better at his craft.
And the backgrounds, there's not as many gradients or anything, and the background characters are more together. So craft-wise, this show is more together too than the previous four. Mm-hmm.
So, Chris, let us know all about We Hate Movies. You've got a lot of podcasts. You've got a great Patreon with even more stuff on there. Please let us know.
We do a weekly show that you can get for free on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. And then we have patreon.com/wehatemovies. We have a bunch of stuff up there. We have a Star Trek show. We got an Animation Damnation, an animation show we do. And we've been doing We Love Movies now. They're monthly. And we're finally doing movies we like, which is a nice turn.
You deserve it.
You earned it.
Thank you.
And you're at Cabin on Twitter, right?
At Crabbin.
Oh, Crabbin. Sorry. Yes.
Yeah, which is an old thing I was called in college for many years. Because I'm crabby.
Well, thank you so much. You weren't crabby on here. That's for sure.
thanks for having me again, guys.
Oh, yeah. So thanks so much to Chris Cabin for joining us today. Please check out We Hate Movies. We're big fans. Of course, just look for We Hate Movies in your podcast machine, or just look up patreon.com/WeHateMovies. Lots of extra stuff there. And we have a Patreon too, mm-hmm. that you probably know about, but if you don't and you want to support our show and get all kinds of extra stuff, please go to patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. And if you sign up at the $5 level, you get every episode 1 week ahead of time and ad-free, and also access to so many bonus podcasts. Over 100 bonus podcasts, including all of our mini-series, the most recent of which was Talking Futurama Season 2, Part 1. 10 new episodes of Talking Futurama, which is just like Talking Simpsons, but about Futurama. And we have 2 new mini-series coming up in 2020, and all kinds of other stuff only on the Patreon that you can only get if you sign up at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. And Henry, what is happening at the $10 level? Extra long podcast every month just for our $10 patrons.
Oh, yeah. For our premium folks out there, they get to hear an extra, extra long podcast once a month. That's our What a Cartoon movie podcast. It's like our sister podcast, What a Cartoon, but about a different animated feature film once a month, where we talk for often over 4 hours about a different animated movie. Back in January, we did The Animatrix, the anime anthology film about the classic 90s film franchise. Plus, before that, we've done movies like Iron Giant and Toy Story and a ton of others that you can only hear in full if you sign up at the $10 level. Over 50 hours of podcasts available to you. $10 a month at patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons.
So I've been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. My other podcast is Retronauts, a classic gaming podcast. Check us out every week at retronauts.com or anywhere you find your podcast. Henry, how about you?
Follow me on Twitter at HENEREYG. Anytime a new thing goes live on the podcast, I'm sure to tweet about it, or when we do live shows like the one we just did in January, you'll learn about it there too. As well, if you're following people on Twitter, follow at TalkSimpsonsPod, because that is the official Twitter account of this podcast, where we share tons of cool information you'll only know if you are a follower. So please follow it at TalkSimpsonsPod on Twitter.
Thanks so much for joining us, folks. We'll see you next week for Moaning Lisa, and we'll see you then.
It was all a mistake. This is how it happened, man. Listen up. You may get a kick out of it. My sister was baking cupcakes this morning.
I'll see you at the flagpole at 3:15.
And you better be prompt. He has 4 other meetings scheduled this afternoon.